Section 20 of Beacon Light of History, Volume 14, The New Era by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Kay Hand. Sir Austen Henry Layard, Part 1. 1817 to 1894. Modern Archaeology. By William Hayes Ward, D.D., LL.D. It was 23 long centuries ago that a Greek soldier of fortune, who had the honor to be also a disciple of Socrates, was leading 10,000 mercenaries back to their native land after their famous failure to set the younger Cyrus on the throne of Persia. Clearchus and the other generals had been treacherously murdered. Dispirited, almost hopeless, on their way to the longed-for Black Sea, in anticipation of the perilous and tedious journey, past wild mountains and wilder Kurds, they toiled up the valley of the Tigris River. Of one incident of their journey, their historian makes no record. They reached the spot where now stands the city of Mosul. On the bank of the river, their eyes fell on a bare and lofty hill. They did not know, they never suspected. Xenophon wrote no word of it, that under that hill lay buried the ruins of one of the mightiest conquering cities that had ever ruled the world. From the palaces of that hill, Ninus and Semiramis and Sardanapalus had led their conquering armies, all now covered with silence. 2 centuries earlier, in 606 BC, there had occurred one of the most tremendous catastrophes recorded in all the grim annals of war. After 1,000 years of primacy in the East, but 20 years after the death of Sardanapalus, the Greek name of Ashurbanipal, who had carried his armies to Egypt and had made his capital the center of the world's culture and magnificence, as it was of its cruel and hated power. Nineveh was captured, buried, and utterly desolated by a horde of savage Scythians from the mountains of the north and east, such people as we now call the Kurds. Its palaces had no lofty Greek columns to stand for memorials, as at Palmyra or Persepolis. And when the outer casings of brick and alabaster were cracked away, and the ashes of the upper stories and the clay of the inner constructions, soaked by the rains, covered the ruins of temple and palace, nothing was left to mark the site but the grass-covered hill. No wonder that the learned scholar of Socrates saw nothing, knew nothing of the city, most glorious and most detested of all the cities of the earth. But in its day, the overthrow of Nineveh and the destruction of the Assyrian Empire had been the most terrible event in the world's history. How the Hebrew prophets gloated over it. Where now is the den of the lions and the feeding place of the young lions, where the lion and the lioness walked, the lion's whelp, and none made them afraid? Woe to the bloody city. It is all full of lies and rapine. The prey departeth not. The noise of the whip and the noise of the rattling of wheels and prancing horses and bounding chariots and horsemen mounting and the flashing sword and the glittering spear, and a multitude of slain, and such a great heap of corpses, and there is no end of the bodies. There is no assuaging of the hurt. Thy wound is grievous. All that hear the report of thee clap their hands over thee, for upon whom hath not thy wickedness passed continually? And another prophet had uttered the curse. The pelican and the porcupine shall lodge in the capitals thereof. Their voice shall sound in the windows. Desolation shall be in the thresholds, for he hath laid bare the cedar work. This is the joyous city that dwelt carelessly, that said in her heart, I am, and there is none besides me. How is she become a desolation, a place for beasts to lie down in? Everyone that passeth by her shall hiss and wag his hand. Thus fell Nineveh, amid the universal rejoicing of the nations, and thus 70 years later fell Babylon also, which, in the short interval, Nebuchadnezzar had made more magnificent than Nineveh had been, beautified for its capture by Cyrus. But before Babylon was the capital of Chaldea, or Nineveh the capital of Assyria, the city of Calla had been the seat of its kings, and a mighty mound, they call it Nimrod now, as high as St. Paul's steeple, old travelers loved to say, marks the place on the east bank of the Tigris, 20 miles south of Nineveh, and, before Calla, Assyria had an earlier capital 40 miles still nearer the Babylonian border at Asher, now Kalashirgat, on the west of the Tigris. And each capital had its palaces and records, and all are now equally buried in clay and utter oblivion. And before the Babylon of Nebuchadnezzar, and long centuries before Nineveh or Calah or Asher, there had been mighty kingdoms in Babylonia, of which the world had quite forgot the names, only vague rumors remaining in song, or legend of Nimrod and Chedorlaomer and Ur of the Chaldees. Only what was preserved in the dimmest records of the Hebrew scriptures. Empires were lost, buried in Gileads of forgetfulness. Would they ever be recovered? And how much else was lost? What kingdoms, what empires buried before Hebrew or Greek history began to take notice of the world outside and put them in books? No one knew. No one knows yet, although so much has been found. The fame of Egypt was never quite forgotten, nor all its history, for Egypt was the world's granary and closely accessible to the ships of Corinth and Rome. And Egypt never lost her civilization in all her long succession of enslavement. But what memory had been kept of the Ionia and Greece of the days before Homer? What of the early civilization of Cyprus and Crete? Only the name of Minos, a judge in hell. What of Persia and Elam? Were they uninhabited before the times of Xerxes and Cyrus? And who were these kings, Cyrus and Xerxes, whose names burst upon us with dim light out of a black antiquity? Even they were but shadows on a screen, just seen and disappearing. What kings and kingdoms came before them and passed away? Has history no record? Not a word. Only black vacuity has been left behind them. And there was that other empire of the East, that of the Hittites, which we now know ruled Asia Minor and Syria and contested the rule of the world with Assyria and Egypt centuries before Agamemnon and Achilles. But so utterly buried and forgotten that not a line of its history was left, not even enough to let the sharpest scholar ask a question or suspect that it ever built capitals and fought victories and produced a civilization, the harvest of which we still enjoy. Nothing was left of them but their names in a Hebrew list of tribes, Amorites and Jebusites and Hivites and Hittites. Yet all these lost tribes, nay, lost nations, had left their records behind them, only they were buried underground and out of sight. What a travesty it is on history and civilization, what an impeachment of the glory of these later Christian centuries, that the lands which these old empires crowded with a busy population should now be among the most desolate and inaccessible on the face of the earth. There we see the curse of the Muslim reign, and still more of the Turkish government. Wherever the Turk has carried the sword and the Quran, there is blight and death. Only as soldiers and scholars of Europe have forced their way into these seats of ancient empires has it been possible to ask and learn what is buried beneath their gray desolation. The man who did more than any other to awaken the interest of the world in the search for forgotten empires was Sir Henry Layard, the excavator of Nineveh. But before his day, another man had startled the world with what we may call the discovery of Egypt. That man was Napoleon Bonaparte, the man whose sword was a plowshare turning up the fallow fields of Europe and sowing strange crops of tyranny and liberty, and whose ambition it was to set up a new throne in the land of the pharaohs and Ptolemies. The mighty ruins of Karnak and the imperishable pyramids filled him with amazement, and he set the scholars of France to work to publish in massive folios the wonders of that most ancient land. Then was found the Rosetta Stone, with its inscription in two languages, Greek, which any scholar could read, and the Egyptian hieroglyphics, which no living man could read. But here was the key. The words Ptolemy and Cleopatra were in the Greek text, and it was not hard to find what were the combinations of characters that stood for these words in Egyptian. The letters P, T, and L were in both names. The hieroglyphic signs found in both names must be these three letters. That beginning gave all the other signs in both words, and the rest of the alphabet soon followed. Justly great is the fame of the Frenchman Champollion, who has the honor of having first deciphered and read this lost language, and opened to us the secret treasures of its history and religion. But with the exploration of Egypt, the scholarship of the world was satisfied for 50 years. No one seemed to think to ask what might be hid under the soil of nearer Palestine and Syria and Asia Minor. much less did they seek to uncover the buried capitals of Assyria and Babylonia. Scholarship was devoted to books, to old manuscripts and convent libraries, to recovering what the wise men of Greece and Rome had written, and trying to wrest new facts out of their blundering old compilations of ancient history. It did not occur to them that 100 kings and 10,000 merchants and priests might have left the stories of their conquests or contracts or liturgies unrotted in the wet soil, imperishably preserved to be the record of commerce and empires as old and as great as those of Egypt, but far deeper covered with oblivion. But there they were, kept safe for 20, 30, 50 centuries, until the man should come whose mission it was to find them. More than one such man came in the middle of the last century, but one man is preeminent and typical of all the rest, Sir Austen Henry Layard. Before him, one Frenchman, M. Paul Emile Botta, had made a fine dash on a palace city a dozen miles north of Nineveh and had opened wonders such as the world had never seen before. But the man whose energy was fullest of impulse, whose enthusiasm compelled British ambassadors and ministers and parliaments to do his bidding, who aroused the world to the importance of the exploration and disinterment of the monuments of Babylonia and Assyria, was the Englishman Layard. He had a youthful passion for adventure and slender means to gratify it. I wish you could see him as he is pictured in the volume which gives the story of his early adventures, before he had settled on his life work of exploration. There he stands clad in his Bakhtiari costume, the dress of a mountain tribe in Persia which asserted its independence of Tehran. He has a well-knit frame, fit to endure hardships. He stands holding the tall matchlock, the curved scimitar by his side, and the long pistol and the dagger in his belt. Above the yellow shoes and party-woven stockings, a red silk robe falls to his ankles, and over that, a green silk garment reaches to his knees. And yet over that, a shorter and richly embroidered coat with open sleeves is held close about the body by a wide silken sash woven in the brightest of red and gold, and holding the weapons attached to his waist. On his head is a low, flat cap, visorless in front, but with a broad bow in place of a feather, all striped with the richest embroidery, and with a wide tassel of the same material falling far down his back. But the face, with its short beard dyed dark with henna and its blue eyes, is not that of a warrior, but of a serious scholar or diplomatist. And he needed all the force of courage and all the arts of diplomacy for the work he had to do. Layard's early training was in the line of preparation for his life's work. Much of his boyhood was spent in Italy, where he acquired a taste for the fine arts, and as much knowledge of them as a child could obtain who was constantly in the society of artists and connoisseurs. At about the age of 16, he was sent to England to study the law, for which he was destined by his parents. After 6 years in the office of a solicitor and in the chambers of an eminent conveyancer, for that is the way that lawyers were educated then, he determined to leave England and seek a career elsewhere. He had a relative in Ceylon who gave him hopes of securing a position there, and for Ceylon he started. A friend of his, 10 years older, was bound for the same destination, both fond of adventure, and they agreed to go together and to go as far as they could by land instead of taking the long sea journey around the Cape of Good Hope. Across Europe they passed to Constantinople, through Austria, Dalmatia, Montenegro, Albania, and Bulgaria. Thence across Asia Minor to Syria and Palestine. Thence to Aleppo and down the Tigris to Baghdad. It was an extraordinary and adventurous journey, often dangerous, but greater danger was to follow. Layard had learned some Turkish, and now he spent the long weeks in Baghdad in the study of Persian. His companion was quite familiar with Arabic. Before they left England, they had received good advice from Sir John McNeill, the British representative at the court of the Shah. You must either travel as important personages, with a retinue of servants and an adequate escort, or alone as poor men, with nothing to excite the cupidity of the people amongst whom you will have to mix. If you cannot afford to adopt the first course, you must take the latter. The latter they were forced to take. Many a young man has the gift to acquire languages. Almost any Oriental can talk 3 or 4, and the ability to rough it and live on the fare of the people, though barbarous. And many a man has the spirit of adventure, but this young man had one peculiar and unusual qualification that directed him to his future career. As a child, he had read the Arabian Nights with intense delight, with their stories centered about Baghdad. Then every book of Eastern adventure, every bit of travel in Syria, Arabia, or Persia that he could find, he had eagerly devoured. It was his day and night's longing that he might visit strange lands of history and make explorations and discoveries. So wherever he was, he visited every ruin and tried to copy every inscription. If his companion would not turn aside to visit some region of renown and danger, he would go alone and join him later. As they came down the river Tigris in their boat, they passed the immense mound of Nimrod, and so impressed was Layard by it that he then, scarce 23 years old, resolved that some day he would search and learn what was hidden under it. But little did he imagine what wonderful monuments he was to find there only a few years later. Without a servant, as poor men, in a caravan of fanatical and hostile Persian pilgrims returning from the shrines, just travelers trying to go by land through Persia and Afghanistan to India and Ceylon, they left Baghdad. It was a time of unusual danger, for the British minister had been recalled from the Persian court, and war with England was threatened. They were taken for spies and sent to the presence of the Shah, and forbidden to follow the route they had chosen and which had been marked out for them by the Council of the Royal Geographical Society, to report on rivers and mountains and ruins not yet explored. They were insulted and robbed, and their lives were often in danger, but at last they received from the Shah their firmans. Now they separated. His companion felt that he must go by the quickest route to his destination, but Layard had no definite date before him, and he was anxious to perform the commissions of the Geographical Society, so he plunged alone into fresh dangers. But there is no space to tell the rest of the story of his adventures among the Bakhtiari, of his copying of inscriptions, of his return to Baghdad, and his decision to give up the plans of life in Ceylon, and of his return from Baghdad again to Schuster and Persepolis and other ancient cities of Persia, and his exploration of the Karen River, and his geographical paper on the subject, his opening of British trade, and his return to Constantinople. At Mosul, he found that M. Bata was planning to explore the mounds across the Tigris that covered ancient Nineveh, and he warmly encouraged his plans. At Constantinople, he visited Sir Stratford Canning and delivered to him despatches that had been confided to his care, in view of a threatened war between Persia and Turkey. Here he was kept in the service of the British Embassy and entrusted with important and delicate negotiations and investigations which were so highly appreciated by Sir Stratford that he kept him as his attaché. Meanwhile, M. Bata had begun his excavations of a palace of King Sargon at Khorsabad and was sending his reports and drawings to Paris. They were all sent by way of Constantinople and, by M. Bata's generosity, were all seen by Mr. Layard. So deeply was he interested in them, and so intense was his desire to carry on excavations himself, that he secured his release from the embassy, and also a grant of $300 from Sir Stratford's own purse, which, with what he could spare from his own money, would, he hoped, suffice to begin the work, when, if anything of value appeared, it was trusted that funds would be secured from English friends of Oriental learning. Thus, 6 years after leaving England, Mr. Layard, well equipped in knowledge of the people and in diplomatic experience, was ready to launch on his great career, which brought him fame and earned him the post in later years of British ambassador at the Porte, which Sir Stratford had held, and, what is far greater, gave to the world the larger part of its knowledge of the lost empires of Assyria and Babylonia. With these few $100 and contributing every penny of his own income, in October of 1845 he left Constantinople without companion or servant, went by steamer to Samsun, and then as fast as post horses could climb or gallop over mountains and plains, he reached Mosul in 12 days. Here at last he was fitted for his task, supplied for the accomplishment of his passion. The Arabs say, "I had a horse but no desert, I had a desert but no horse. Now I have a desert and a horse, and shall I not ride?" His boyhood with the artists of Italy and learning the languages of the continent had fitted him for his task. Then his study of all the books of Eastern travel, then half a year wandering with a trained companion through Asia Minor and Syria, scarcely leaving untrod one spot hallowed by tradition, or unvisited one ruin consecrated by history, with no protection but his arms, living with the people and learning their prejudices and customs. Then an irresistible desire had brought him to the regions beyond the Euphrates, and the mystery of Assyria, Babylonia, and Chaldea had fascinated him, so that he had visited the land of Nimrod, seen the site of their old buried capitals, had been the guest in the tents of Shamar and Anaza Arabs, and even passed on to see the famous 40 columns of Kilmenar, and to penetrate the mountain fastnesses where the Bakhtiari maintained a perilous freedom. Never was man better trained by enthusiasm and experience for his task, and the late discoveries of M. Botta had inflamed his desire to surpass what his French friend had done. End of section 20. Section 21 of Beacon Lights of History, Volume 14, The New Era by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by K. Hand. Sir Austen Henry Layard, Part 2. His plan was not to begin excavations at Nineveh, opposite Mosul, but 20 miles south, at the great mound of Nimrod, which bore the name of the mighty hunter Nimrod. Xenophon and his 10,000 had seen and wondered at its pyramid. There he would be free from the army of mischievous spectators that would swarm from Mosul, had he selected the site of Nineveh, and from the constant interference of the Turkish governor. The pasha at Mosul was a cruel scoundrel who was robbing and killing the people as his whim or greed prompted, and had reduced the tribes of the neighborhood to a state of terror. Accordingly, Mr. Layard, who was armed with protecting letters from the British ambassador and the port, thought it wise to conceal his purpose, let it be reported that he was going on a hunting expedition, and with a few tools and a supply of guns and spears, on the 8th of November, 1845, accompanied only by his cawass, the soldier attendant detailed for the protection of travelers, a servant and one laborer, he floated down the Tigris and in 4 hours reached the bourne of his long hopes. He had the mound, he had the money, and now he would dig. The Arabs have strange stories of this ruin. The palace, they say, was built by Ather, the vizier of Nimrod. There Abraham brake in pieces the idols worshipped by the unbelievers. Nimrod was angry and waged war on the holy patriarch. Abraham prayed to God, "Deliver me, O God, from this man who worships stones and boasts himself to be Lord of all the kings." And God said to him, "How shall I punish him?" And the prophet answered, "To thee armies are as nothing, and the strength and power of men likewise. Before the smallest of thy creatures will they perish." And God was pleased at the faith of his servant, and he sent a gnat that vexed Nimrod day and night, so that he built himself a room of glass in that palace, that he might dwell therein and shut out the insect. But the gnat entered also, and passed by his ear into his brain, upon which it fed, and increased day by day, so that the servants of Nimrod beat his head continually with a mallet, that he might have some ease from his pain. But he died after suffering these torments 400 years. And after him the mound was named Nimrod. It was dark when Layard and his little company reached the place. They found nearby a few huts occupied by poor Arabs who had been harried by the Turkish pasha. There they slept, or tried to sleep, but the explorer could not sleep. Hear him. Hopes, long cherished, were now to be realized, or were to end in disappointment. Visions of palaces underground, of gigantic monsters, of sculpted figures, and endless inscriptions floated before me. After forming plan after plan for removing the earth and extricating these treasures, I fancied myself wandering in a maze of chambers from which I could find no outlet. Then again all was reburied, and I was standing on the grass-covered mound. Exhausted, I was at length sinking into sleep, when hearing the voice of Awad, I rose from my carpet and joined him outside the tent. The day had already dawned. The lofty cone and broad mound of Nimrod broke like a distant mountain on the morning sky. Awad, his host, was a little chief among the Arabs and was engaged to take charge of the diggers. The first morning he had 6 Arabs at work and found alabaster slabs with cuneiform inscriptions. He was now sure he would succeed. It is not necessary to give the diary of his work. To be sure, the villainous pasha forbade him to continue and recalled him to Mosul, but a new governor was sent from Constantinople under whom he had no difficulty. A great palace had been found, and chamber after chamber was excavated, the walls covered with bas-reliefs and inscriptions. Then came strange, gigantic lions with human heads that had been placed by the old Assyrian king to guard the entrances to his court. What was the amazement of the Arabs and Turks cannot be told. First, the head was uncovered. It stood out from the earth, placid and vast. Here Layard tell the story. He had been away to visit a neighboring chief. I was returning to the mound when I saw two Arabs urging their mares to the top of their speed. "Hasten, obey," exclaimed one of them. "Hasten to the diggers, for they have found Nimrod himself. By Allah, it is wonderful, but it is true. We have seen him with our eyes. There is no God but God." And both joining in this pious exclamation, they galloped back to the tent. Layard hastened to the trench, and there he saw what he knew to be the head of a gigantic lion or bull, such as Bata had uncovered at Khorsabad. It was an admirable preservation. The expression was calm yet majestic, and the outline of the features showed a freedom and knowledge of art that was scarcely to be looked for at so early a period. Says the explorer, "I was not surprised that the Arabs had been amazed and terrified at this apparition. It required no stretch of imagination to conjure up the most strange fancies. The gigantic head, blanched with age, thus rising from the bowels of the earth, might well have belonged to one of those fearful beings which are pictured in the traditions of the country as appearing to mortals, slowly ascending from the regions below." "This is not the work of men's hands," exclaimed Sheikh Abdurrahman, who had galloped to the mound on the first news, "but of those infidel giants of whom the prophet, peace be with him, has said that they were higher than the tallest date tree. This is one of the idols which Noah, peace be with him, cursed before the flood." In this opinion, all the bystanders concurred. The Arabs have a ready explanation for every fresh discovery. When some years later, Mr. Layard's assistant and successor in the work of excavation, Mr. Rassam, uncovered at Abu Haba a remarkable bas-relief with the figure of the seated sun god and three approaching worshippers, the Arab diggers rushed to him, declaring that they had found Noah and his three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and demanded a sheep to make a feast. The report of the wonderful discovery of a royal palace, evidently older than those of Nineveh, with magnificent decorations in alabaster and cuneiform inscriptions, reached beyond Mosul to Constantinople. Sir Stratford Canning was delighted with the result of his expedition. He had a passion for discovery as well as diplomacy, and it is to him that the British Museum is indebted for the priceless marbles of Halicarnassus. He now obtained for Mr. Layard a firman, permitting him to make what excavations he wished. Then the news reached London, and the British Museum made a grant to support the work. All difficulties were now removed. Conditions were even more favorable for him than they are now. There was then no imperial museum in Constantinople to which all objects found must be taken, but those that dug had the right to carry off their prizes to London or Paris. To tell the story of the further excavations is unnecessary. It is all given in Layard's two splendid volumes, Nineveh and its Fine Remains, and Babylon and Nineveh. And the bas-reliefs, statues, bronzes, ivories, and inscriptions are magnificently reproduced in great folio volumes. From Nimrod, he went back to Mosul, and there opened the two mounds opposite Kuyunjik and Nebiyunus, the site of old Nineveh. There, more palaces and friezes were found of other kings. Then he went back to London, closing his successful campaign, more profitable, if not more glorious, than those of war, and published the story of his work. Its effect was marvelous. No such popular book of travels had ever appeared, for it was a story of adventure and also of strange discovery. Mr. Layard had not suspected that he had the literary gift, but he had it in rare measure. He had gained an interview of the heart of tribes, Muslim and Christian and semi-pagan, by his sympathy with them and his knowledge of their tongues. He had lived in their tents and huts. He had saved them from persecution by Turkish governors. Their gratitude to him was beyond words, and he told their story with affection and enthusiasm. Then his discoveries were in lands made historic not only by the campaigns of Xenophon and Alexander, but made almost sacred by the Bible history. These were the lands whence came the armies that fought with Israel. These were the kings whose wars are told in the Jewish records, and the annals of these kings were found in their palaces, and they gave full accounts of wars of which the Bible had given the outline. Piety and learning joined to give extraordinary interest to these discoveries and to this report of them. Mr. Layard found himself famous, and the monuments he was bringing to the British Museum were, and still are, the most extraordinary and fascinating in all its corridors. Of course, a new grant was made in behalf of the British Museum, and of course he went back to continue and extend his researches. Now he wished to go further south, beyond Nimrod to Kala-Shergat, the yet earlier capital of Assyria, and yet further to Babylon, that he might see and test the multitude of mounds of ancient Chaldea, the real land of Nimrod, the seat of Eden, and the Tower of Babel, far more ancient than any one of the three capitals of Assyria. While he did scarce more than to visit and report on the Babylonian mounds, his diggings in Nineveh itself were of vast importance, for there he found the library of Ashurbanabal on clay tablets, which has given us our chief knowledge of the literature and learning of the ancient East. In 1852, he returned to England to publish his Monuments of Nineveh and left the further exploration to his able lieutenant, Mr. Rassam, and to a noble succession of explorers who should follow, and to a no less noble line of scholars who should interpret the inscriptions and recover the history of the nations, so that we now know more exactly the history of Babylonian and Assyrian kings, and from more authentic records, and more completely the social condition and business life of the countries, than we do the history of Greece, or the life of the Greeks even at the time of Pericles, and that, too, for a period of 3,000 years. To illustrate this fact, let us take the black obelisk of Shalmaneser II, found by Layard at Nimrod. It is a column of basalt 7 feet high and about 2 feet wide at the base, from which it narrows slightly, until near the top it is reduced by 3 steps. On the 4 sides is engraved in 5 rows of bas-reliefs, 20 in all, the pictured history of the royal conquests, the submission of kings, and the presentation of tribute. Above and below, and between, in 210 lines, was cut an inscription which explained the figures and gave a full historical and, of course, contemporary and official account of the glorious events of the royal reign. Not a line was defaced. At the British Museum, it can be seen today as perfect as when engraved 27 centuries ago. Other monuments of Shalmaneser have been found. One is a great monolith with a portrait of the king in all his fine array, and with 156 lines of text. Another is a series of splendid bronze plates that covered great wooden gates, on which, in repoussé work, were pictures of the royal victories, and inscriptions explaining them. The Bible tells us of the rivalries and jealousies of Ahab and Jehu, kings of Israel, and Ben-Hadad and Hazael, kings of Damascus. How surprising it is to find here not only the story of the successive campaigns of Shalmaneser against these same kings, the number of their chariots and soldiers, but to see pictured before us the tribute sent by Jehu. We learn that Shalmaneser reigned from 859 to 825 BC, and we have the record of all his successive campaigns, the first 26 of which he led in person. There is not another country of which, before the invention of printing, we have so minute a history. And all had been lost, except the mention of a name or two, whether historical or legendary, we hardly knew, until Layard and his fellow explorers opened the mounds of Assyria. But enough for Layard. He is only one, though the principal one, of all the explorers of the buried records of the empires of the Tigris and Euphrates. And Babylonia and Assyria are not the only countries that history required us to explore. Greece and its neighboring states and islands have not even yet been fairly investigated. Much of Asia Minor is still a virgin field. Syria and Palestine have hardly been scratched with the spade. More has been done in Egypt, but more yet is to be done. And when we go into the further east of Persia and old Elam, not to speak of the yet farther east of Central Asia, now just beginning to yield strange treasures to daring travelers, and ancient India and China, how ancient we know not at all, there is field for centuries of further research. For we must go back past empires and kingdoms and tribal conditions to the very beginning of the human race on earth, even if it so be to the first Pithecanthropus, which men of science tell us was the link which connected Homo sapiens with the race of primitive simians. And all this, it may well be, is preserved in undecaying records just a few feet under the ground. If only one knew where to dig for it. Nay, we now know where to dig for the most and best of it, and we only await the Stratford Cannings, who will give the money, and the Austen Layards, who have the enthusiasm for the work. After Layard and Rassam, after Rawlinson and Botta, George Smith took flying trips to the site of Nineveh twice, that he might gather the remaining fragments of the great library of Ashurnababel, and he died in the field far from home. It was he who that found among Layard's tablets the Babylonian account of the deluge, so much like that in the Bible. He was the first of a second generation who, following Rawlinson and Oppert, decipherers as well as explorers, were able to read as they found. I can only mention the names of the Englishmen Taylor and Loftus, of the Frenchmen Placé and de Sarzac, and later the Americans Peters, Hilprecht, and Haynes, who have so faithfully explored the extremely archaic mound of Niffer, which I had the honor to recommend for excavation after I had visited the mounds of southern Babylonia in the winter of 1884-85. And now the Germans, with scientific as well as commercial and political purpose, with their railroad to pass down the valley through Baghdad to the Persian Gulf, which gives them predominant influence, have sent expeditions well equipped with scholars and engineers to the choicest sites in Babylonia, to Warka, the ancient Erech, and to Babylon itself. And with Teuton thoroughness, they are excavating the most famous of ancient ruins and gathering fresh treasures of archaeological research. Nor have they left the land of the Hittites unexplored, for Germany claims the first rights, politically, in all Anatolia, the right of succession and possession when the Turk is expelled, and German archaeological science is bound to be first on that field. And now, what have we found as the fruit of all this labor of exploration? Is it worth the labor and the expense? Let us look first, it can only be a glance, at Egypt, for Egypt was the land first and most persistently explored. The French government for scores of years has been at work there. Germans and Italians have explored the ruins, two English societies have for years kept expeditions in the field, and just now a Californian university sends an American Egyptologist to uncover the tombs and read the hieroglyphs of the kings. Not only are the figured monuments of Egypt published in princely folios, but its records have been translated and its lost history recovered to the world's knowledge. Instead of the bare pharaoh of the Bible, a common designation for all the kings, and in place of a bare list of names and dynasties copied from Mentheo, and so altered and corrupted in the copying as to be neither Greek nor Egyptian, we have on scarab, or gravestone, or pyramid, or rock sepulchre wall, in his own spelling, the name of almost every king from the latest time of the Ptolemies back to the first king of the first dynasty, 5,000, or was it 6,000, years before Christ. And not their names only, but the very picture of their wars. We see how they went up the Nile and fought the blacks of Abyssinia, and brought back the spoils of Punt Ui. See them sending their squadrons into Syrian Asia and waging a dubious battle with the Hittites before the walls of Hamath, where Ramses, in his lion-guarded chariot, performs prodigies of valor, and from which he returns not only to paint on sacred walls the picture of his victory, but also to inscribe a copy of the Treaty of Peace with the Hittite king, the earliest treaty in the preserved annals of diplomacy. Well wrought that Ramses the Great, for eternal fame in the 60 years of his reign, 15 centuries before the birth of our Lord. But what fame had been his, had not explorers and excavators and scholars dug and found and copied and translated what the sands had covered for centuries. And today, the curious traveler stops in sight of the pyramids on the banks of the Nile and enters the Bulaq Museum, and there he sees, set up before him, the very mummy of Ramses himself, and of a dozen other royal personages, rifled from their tombs and displayed for your amazement and mine. There is the very pharaoh. You can see his features, you can touch his coffin, who chased the children of Israel out of Egypt. There are the household implements, the furniture of their homes, the jewelry their queens wore, queens who were also sisters of the kings, as Sarah was the sister of Abraham. Or would you know of some great revolution in Egypt? These decipherers of the inscriptions will tell you how the shepherd kings overthrew the native dynasty, coming with their armies from Asia long before Ramses, and changed religion and customs, under whom Jacob and his sons found hospitable welcome, until their hated race was expelled by a stronger native dynasty that knew not Joseph. Or they will tell you of the royal reformer Tunakten, son of a famous Eastern mother, a queen from the banks of the Euphrates. Taught by her, perhaps, a purer religion, he attempted to replace the worship of Egypt's bestial gods by the worship of the one only great god, whose symbol was the sun. But the priestly clan was too strong for him, and the succeeding pharaohs destroyed his records and chiseled out his name where it had been cut in stone, that no memory of his sacrilege might be preserved. A royal Moses there could not be. The worshipper of one god, whether king or son of Pharaoh's daughter, could bring no reformation to Egypt. End of section 21. Section 22 of Beacon Lights of History, Volume 14, The New Era by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Kay Hand. Sir Austen Henry Layard, Part 3. Or would you learn how Egypt ruled its subject territory? You can read the correspondence of a dozen local Egyptian governors in Palestine and Syria in the century before Moses led the Hebrew slaves out of Egypt. There is the letter of the king of Jerusalem, where Melchizedek reigned in the times of Abraham, and they tell of rebellions against the fading power of Egypt and of the fear of the advancing Hittites. The earliest kings, those that built the pyramids, appear before us, real in their personality, emerging out of misty legend or myth, and earlier still, even the prehistoric races that antedated the very beginning of civilization. Whence came that first dynasty? Who invented writings? Were they autochthons? Hardly. These are questions left for further explorers to answer. Probably those first messengers of civilization came from the East, perhaps from Arabia, perhaps from Babylonia, or perhaps the first Babylonians and Egyptians formed a common stock somewhere near the mouth of the Euphrates. Perhaps the Bible is right in saying that the first seat of civilized man was in Eden, and that the Euphrates was the chief river of paradise. Or was it from Arabia, the immemorial home of the Semitic tribes, that land of sand and mountain and fertile valley, land of changeless culture and tradition, so near the centers of civilization, and yet still the most inaccessible, the least known portion of the inhabited earth? Was it from Arabia that the wiser, stronger multitude came that first overran the valleys of both the Nile and the Euphrates, bringing to Egypt and Chaldea arts and letters? We do not know. Some future explorer must teach us. But the German glazier has, within these few years, brought back from hazardous journeys a multitude of inscriptions that tell of kingdoms that fringed its southern coast and extended we know not how far into the interior in those early days when one of the queens of Sheba brought presents to Solomon, and when, earlier still, we are told there were dukes of Edom before there was any king in Israel. They say that a railroad is to be built to Mecca. Arabia is not to be always a closed land, neighbor as it is to Egypt. We shall know one of these days whether, as scholars suspect, out of Arabia and across the straits of Bab el-Mandeb, where at the southern end of the Red Sea, Africa almost touches Asia, there came that mighty flood of more forceful men, bred in the deserts and hills, who, passing down the Nile, first brought history to Egypt. And whether it was this same Semitic people, as scholars suspect again, that spread resistlessly eastward to the Euphrates Valley and did an equal service in conquering and assimilating the black aborigines of these swamps and lagoons. The spade will tell us. Or was it still further east, in the highlands of Persia, that men first learned how to write and record history? We cannot go back so far in the history of Babylonia. Professor Hilprecht dares to carry us 7,000 years before Christ, that we do not find its kings fighting against Elam. And only in the last decade of the 19th century, the Frenchman De Morgan has made marvelous discoveries in the Elamite lands. What a noble passion those Frenchmen have for discovery. For Egypt, did not Napoleon provide the most elephantine books of monuments and records that printing presses have yet issued? And from that time to this, have not Frenchmen held the primacy in excavations until, even while England holds and rules Egypt, she leaves by special convention the care of its monuments and their exploration to French savants? And before Layard removed a basketful of the earth that covered the palace of Shalmaneser at Nimrod, had not the Frenchman Bata disclosed the friezes and sphinxes of Sargon at Khorsabad? And in these late years, is it not the Frenchman de Sarzac who has brought from Tello to the Louvre the statues of Chaldean kings that lived almost 5,000 years ago? And so to France was given the right, for the honor and enrichment of the Louvre, to explore Persia. And De Morgan went to Susa, to Shushan, the palace of Xerxes and Darius, of Ahasuerus and Esther, in search of what was far earlier than they. For another Frenchman and his wife, Monsieur and Mademoiselle de la Foy, had already excavated the noble palace of these Persian kings. Far below the palace of Xerxes, he has found vastly earlier remains. There is the column set up, if we can believe the Assyriologists who trust the chronology of Nabonidus, the last king of Babylon, and it is not incredible, 3,800 years before Christ, by Naramsin, a Babylonian king, to commemorate one of his raids into the land of what were perhaps his stronger enemies. It is a noble composition, with archaic writing and a stately figure of the king climbing the mountains and slaying his enemies. It shows an art that might well have developed into the best that Greece has produced. But De Morgan has only begun to scratch the surface of the mounds of Elam, and a multitude of scholars believe that out of Elam came the first civilization of Chaldea. We shall find out yet, for the record is in the earth, and only waits the man who will dig it out, and then the man who will read it. We are tempted to go further east and recall that in India, the land where Alexander made his most distant conquests, a multitude of English scholars have been searching the ruins of old temples for the earliest memorials of the worship of Buddha. Just now they have found his birthplace and precious relics. But that takes us too far afield and would tempt us to further excursions in Burma and China. We must come back to Western Asia and the shores of Europe. As has been indicated, the greatest puzzle of ancient history is that of the Hittite Empire, which seems to have ruled all Asia Minor at some uncertain time, and to have extended over Syria and Palestine. No sooner had the greatest Egyptian kings, Thothmes and Ramses, ventured their armies into Asia, perhaps in vengeance on the incursions of Ionian pirates, perhaps in requital of the tyrannies of the hated shepherd kings, than they learned of the Hittites on the shores of the Euphrates. Then, a century or two later, a mass of official correspondence sent by the kings of Palestine and Syria, dug up in Egypt, reports that the Hittites had appeared as invaders from the north and besieges military aid. But the power of Egypt had waned, and the Hittites were supreme until the Assyrians began and carried on for five centuries the uncertain war which ended in the utter overthrow of the Hittites and all their allies in a great battle at Carchemish. That great mound of Carchemish needs to be thoroughly explored. Already an English expedition has very carelessly just opened the hill and exposed, but not fairly published, some few as fine friezes as are to be found in the Assyrian capitals, with unread Hittite inscriptions and a fine statue of the Hittite Venus. But much remains to reward the student of Oriental history and art. At Sinjerli, a German expedition under von Lushan has done more and better work, handsomely published, but this was a smaller Syrian town and less was to be expected. And yet here and nearby were found what was not expected. Steles, upright slabs or pillars, with the portraits of kings in high relief, covered over with long inscriptions in Aramaic, the oldest and longest as yet discovered anywhere in that language. It was a magnificent result of very moderate labor. Hittite friezes, Assyrian and Aramean inscriptions all in one little mound. But, for the most part, we know the art and writing of the Hittites from what we have found above ground, in their towns and fortresses in the hills, for little digging has been done. At Terium was a principal sacred capital, and there, on a natural corridor of rock, they carved a procession of gods and kings and soldiers that excites the wonders of scholars. As I write, the announcement comes that Professor Sayce has at last discovered the secret of the Hittite hieroglyphs, and we may hope that very soon it will be possible to read them. But there is vastly more of their records yet to be disinterred. And there remain the two lands most sacred and beloved in poetry and history, the land of Israel and the land of Homer. It is amazing that so little search has been made to find out what is hidden under the soil of Palestine. Scholars in plenty have walked over the top of it and have told all that is on the surface, but almost nothing has been done underground. No such excavations as in Egypt or Assyria. I do not forget that the English Palestine Exploration Fund has followed out, with trenches and tunnels, the walls of Jerusalem, nor that one or two old mounds have been partly explored. But what is this to the great work that needs to be done? There has been found on the surface the Moabite stone at the old capital of Dibon, a wonderful record of early kings mentioned in the Bible. And there is the short account in the rock-cut conduit of Siloam of the success of the workmen in the time of Hezekiah, who, beginning at the two ends, did the fine engineering feat of having their tunnels meet correctly in the solid rock. But when Jerusalem is fully explored, in the northern capitals of Bethel and Tisra and Samaria, and a hundred other mounds that mark the site of Jewish, Israelite, Philistine, and Amorite cities, we may expect marvelous discoveries that will illumine our holy scriptures. And one region yet remains to be considered, the scattered coasts and islands that owned the Greek speech, and that created the Greek civilization. It is not the Greece of the Parthenon and Pericles that we wish to discover, for that we fairly know, but the arts and the history of those earlier Greeks and Trojans that Homer tells of, the age of Agamemnon and Ulysses, of Helen and Hector and Priam, and of the yet earlier tribes that sailed the Aegean and settled the Mediterranean islands and sent their ships to the Egyptian coasts and sought golden fleeces on the Euxine Sea. All about the coast of Asia Minor they lived, while that Hittite power was ruling the interior, and intermixed with Phoenician trading posts, they held the great islands of Crete and Cyprus and the shores of Sicily and Italy. What shall we call them? Were they Dorians, or Heraclidae, or Achaeans, or Pelasgi? Were they of the same race as the mysterious Etruscans? Or shall we name them simply Mycenaeans, as we call the art Mycenaean that ruled the islands and coasts down to the Homeric age? And we know not how many centuries earlier, but certainly as far back as the conquering period of the 18th Egyptian dynasty of Thothmes. Their soldiers and merchants and their fine vases are pictured on the walls of Egypt, and their pottery has long been studied. But we knew little of them until Dr. Schliemann, the Greek merchant who achieved wealth in the United States, bravely opened the great ruins of Troy, in the full patriotism of his assurance that Homer's story of the Trojan War was history as well as poetry. As he found one burnt and buried city under another, for many times was Troy destroyed, and extended his investigations to Tiryns and other ancient cities, one volume of splendid research followed another, until the traitor had compelled the unwilling scholar to confess that he must dig for both history and art. To be sure, his interpretations were quite too literal at first, but the whole world of classical scholarship has learned from him the new method of research. Splendid have been the results. If we are not sure which stratum represents the city of Priam, we do learn how the people lived, and how fine was their work in silver and gold, and how slight their knowledge of letters. Dr. Schliemann has now a multitude of imitators. France and Germany and England and the United States each maintain a school of archaeology in Athens, and each conducts careful explorations. Our American school lost to the French, for lack of money at the right time, the chance to explore Delphi, but it has carried on careful explorations at Corinth and other places. How wonderful was the discovery not long ago of a shipload of bronze and marble statues wrecked while being transported as spoil of war from Corinth to Rome. But the most surprising discoveries in the realm of old Greek history and art are those that have been made in these last 2 or 3 years in Crete. Crete was a famous center of ancient Greek legend. Jupiter was born and reared on Mount Ida. From another mountain summit in Crete, the gods watched the battle on the plains of Troy. There ruled Minos, who first gave laws to men, and who at his death was sent by the gods to judge the shades as they entered the lower world. There was the famous labyrinth, and there the Minotaur devoured his annual tale of maidens until he was slain by Theseus. Was there such a real place of Minos as the Greek poets sung? The magnificent palace of the Cretan kings at Knossos has been found by Mr. Evans, with its friezes, its spiral ornaments, its flounce-petticoated women, its treasuries, and its tablets written in a script so old that it cannot yet be read, but which will be read as surely as scholarship leaves none of its riddles unsolved. The childhood of Greece, its mighty infancy, out of which it grew to be the creator and the example of all the world's culture, is even now being exposed to our view, safely kept to be recovered by the scholars of our generation. Of interest rather to the student of the curiosities of history are the mounds and pyramids of temples built by the Aborigines of America. for these tribes have had absolutely no part in creating our dominant civilization or developing its art. China and Japan are, at this late day, giving something to the world's store of beauty and utility, but the mound builders and cliff dwellers, the Mayas and Toltecs and Incas, have given absolutely nothing which the world cared to accept. But this does not argue that it is not worthwhile to learn what we can of the rude civilization of the races whom we have displaced. Their arrowheads and hatchets are in every little museum. Their mounds, sometimes shaped like serpents or tortoises or lizards, are scattered all over the central states, and many of them have been carefully explored with scanty results. The cliff dwellers have left somewhat richer remains, more baskets and parched corn, yet nothing of artistic value. We have to go to Mexico and Yucatan and farther south to Peru to find the majestic capitals of the Mayas and Incas, who had really reached a fair degree of such civilization as stone and copper, without iron, and the beginnings of picture symbols without letters could provide. Humboldt and Stevens and Lord Kingsborough and Squire and Chudy and Charney have made explorations and found vast and wonderful cities, some of them deserted and overgrown before Cortez and Pizarro took possession of the lands for Spain and enslaved the people. Where the city of Mexico now stands was a famous capital from whose ruins were taken the great calendar stone and the double statue of the god of war and the god of death. In Palenque and Yuxmal, capitals of Yucatan, were immense palaces and temples with weird ornamentation of Mayan imagination, and equal wonders exist in the high uplands where the Incas ruled Peru. Even their barbaric art and their unrecorded history must be recovered to satisfy the curiosity of the more fortunate races whose boasted Christianity visited on them nothing better than cruel slaughter. At least we can give them museums and publish magnificent pictures of their ruins. So we may bless the ashes and sand that seem to destroy and bury the monuments of the mighty empires of the ancient world, but which have kindly covered and preserved them, just as we put our treasures away in some safety vault while absent on a long journey. The fire burned the upper wooden walls of the city and it fell in ruins. But under those ruins, covered by that ashes, were preserved for 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 years uninjured, the choicest sculpture and the most precious records of ancient nations, retained beyond the reach of vandal hands, until scholarship had grown wise enough to ask questions of forgotten history, and had sent Layard and Schliemann and de Sarzac and Evans and 100 other men to dig with their competitive spades. But in all the long list of enthusiasts, not one deserves a higher honor or has reaped a richer harvest than Sir Henry Layard. Authorities: Layard, Early Adventures, Nineveh and Its Remains, Nineveh and Babylon, Monuments of Nineveh. Bot, Monument de Nineveh, Loftus, Chaldea and Susiana. Y Place, Nineveh et Assyria, Hilprecht, Babylonian Expedition of the University of Pennsylvania, Recent Research in Bible Lands. Perrault and Chipes, History of Art in Antiquity, J.P. Peters, Nippur, R.W. Rogers, History of Babylonia and Assyria, F. Lenormant, Student's Manual of the Ancient History of the East, The Beginnings of History, Maspero, Dawn of Civilization, Struggle of the Nations, Passing of the Empires, Egyptian Archaeology, Life in Ancient Egypt and Assyria, C.J. Ball, Light from the East, Egypt Exploration Funds Publications, F.J. Bliss, Exploration in Jerusalem, A Mound of Many Cities, Schliemann, Troy and Its Remains, Ilios, Mycena, Tiryns, Troja, A.J. Evans, Gnosis, Cretan Pictographs, Toussaint's Amenat, The Mycenaean Age. End of section 22. Section 23 of Beacon Lights of History, Volume 14, The New Era by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Kay Hand. Michael Faraday, Part 1. 1791 to 1867. Electricity and Magnetism. By Edwin J. Houston, Ph.D. No man is born into the world whose work is not born with him. There is always work, and tools to work withal for those who will. Lowell. A man was born into the world on the 22nd of September, 1791, whose work was born with him, and who did this work so well that he became one of its greatest benefactors. Indeed, much of the marvelous advance made in the electric arts and sciences during the last half century can be directly traced to his work. It was in Newington Butts in London, England, that the man-child first opened his eyes on the wonders of the physical world around him. To those eyes, in after years, were given a far deeper insight into the mysteries of nature than often falls to the lot of man. This man-child was Michael Faraday, who has been justly styled, by those best capable of judging him, the Prince of Experimental Philosophers. The precocity so common in the childhood of men of genius was apparently absent in the case of young Faraday. The growing boy played marbles and worried through a scant education in reading, writing, and arithmetic, unnoticed, and most probably for the greater part, severely left alone, as commonly falls to the lot of nearly all boys, whether ordinary or extraordinary. At the early age of 13, he was taken from school and placed on trial as an errand boy in the bookshop of George Ribot in London. After a year at this work, he was taken as an apprentice to the bookbinding trade by the same employer, who, on account of his faithful services, remitted the customary premium. At this work, he spent some 8 years of his life. But far be it from us even to hint at the absence of genius in the young child. Genius is not an acquired gift. It is born in the individual. Apart from the marvelous achievements of the man, a mere glance at the magnificent head, with its high intellectual forehead, the firm lips, the intelligent inquiring eyes, and the bright face, as seen in existing pictures, assures us that they portray an unusual individuality, incompatible with even a suspicion of belonging to an ordinary man. Doubtless, the growing child did give early promise of his future greatness. Doubtless, he was a formidable member of that terrible class of inquiring youngsters who demand the why and the wherefore of all around them, and refuse to accept the unsatisfactory belief of their fathers that things are because they are. In its self-complacency, the busy world is too apt to fail to notice unusual abilities in children, abilities that perhaps too often remain undeveloped from lack of opportunities. But whether young Faraday did or did not at an early age display any unusual promise of his life work, all his biographers appear to agree that he could not be regarded as a precocious child. Faraday disclaimed the idea that his childhood was distinguished by any precocity. "Do not suppose that I was a very deep thinker or was marked as a precocious person," says Faraday, when alluding to his early life. "I was a very lively, imaginative person and could believe in the Arabian Nights as easily as the encyclopedia, but facts were important to me and saved me. I could trust a fact and always cross-examined an assertion. So when I questioned Mrs. Marseille's book," he is alluding to her Conversations on Chemistry, "by such little experiments as I could find to perform, and found it true to the facts as I could understand them, I felt that I had got hold of an anchor in chemical knowledge and clung fast to it." But while there may be a question as to the existence of precocity in the young lad, there does not appear to be any reason for believing that his unusual abilities were the result of direct heredity. His father, an ordinary journeyman blacksmith, never exhibited any special intellectual ability, though possibly poverty and poor health may have been responsible for this failure. His mother, too, it appears, was of but ordinary mentality. The environment of those early years, that is, from 1804 to 1813, while in the bookbinding business, was far from calculated to develop any marked abilities inherent in our young philosopher. What would seem less calculated to inspire a wish to obtain a deeper insight into the mysteries of the physical world than the trade of bookbinding, especially in the case of a boy whose scholastic education ceased at 14 years and was limited to the mere rudiments of learning. But fortunately for the world, the inquiring spirit of the lad led him to examine the inside of the books he bound, and thus, by familiarizing himself with their contents, he received the inspiration that good writing is always ready to bestow on those who properly read it. Two books, he afterwards informs us, proved of especial benefit. Namely, Marseille's Conversations on Chemistry, already referred to, and the Encyclopedia Britannica. To the former, he attributes his grounding in chemistry, and to the latter, his first ideas in electricity, in both of which studies he excelled in after years. As we have seen, even at this early age, he followed the true plan for the physical investigator, cross-questioned all statements, only admitting those to the dignity of facts whose truth he had established by careful experimentation. But our future experimental philosopher has not, as yet, fairly started on the beginnings of his life work. The possibilities of the bookbinding trade were too limited to permit much real progress. A circumstance occurred in the spring of 1812 that shaped his entire afterlife. This was the opportunity then afforded him to attend four of the last lectures delivered at the Royal Institution by the great Sir Humphrey Davy. Faraday took copious notes of these lectures, carefully wrote them out, and bound them in a small quarto volume. It was this volume which he afterwards sent to Davy that resulted in his receiving, on March 1, 1813, the appointment of laboratory assistant in the Royal Institution. His pay for this work was 25 shillings a week with a lodging on the top floor of the Institute, a very fair compensation for the times. Very congenial were the duties of the young assistant. They were to keep clean the beloved apparatus of the lecturers and to assist them in their demonstrations. The new world thus opened was full of bright promise. He keenly felt the deficiencies of his early education and did his best to extend his learning so that he might be able to make the most of his opportunities. But what he perhaps appreciated the most was the inspiration he received from the great teacher Davy, who was then professor of chemistry and director of the laboratory of the Royal Institution. For Faraday assisted at Davy's lectures, and in an humble way even aided his investigations, sharing the dangers arising from the explosion of the unstable substance, chloride of nitrogen, that Davy was then investigating. Faraday has repeatedly acknowledged the debt owed to the inspiration of this teacher. Davy also, in later life, generously recognized, in his former assistant, a philosopher greater than himself. As the renowned astronomer Tycho Brahe discovered in one of his pupils, John Kepler, an astronomer greater than the master, and as Bergman, the Swedish chemist, in a similar manner, discovered the greater chemist Scheele, so when Davy, in after years, was asked what he regarded as his greatest discovery, he briefly replied, Michael Faraday. The task of the scientific historian, who endeavors honestly to record the progress of research and to trace the influence of the work of some individual on the times in which he lived, is by no means an easy one. For, in scientific work, one discovery frequently passes so insensibly into another that it is often difficult to know where one stops and the other begins, and much difficulty constantly arises as to whom the credit should be given, when, as is too often the case, these discoveries are made by different individuals. It is only when some great discovery stands alone, like a giant mountain peak against the clear sky, that it is comparatively easy to determine the extent and character of its influence on other discoveries, and justly to give the credit to whom the credit is due. Such discoveries form ready points of reference in the intellectual horizon and mark distinct eras in the world's progress. This is true of all work in the domain of physical science, but it is especially true in that of electricity and magnetism, in which Faraday was preeminent. The scope of each of these sciences is so extended, the number of workers so great, and the applications to the practical arts so nearly innumerable, that it is often by no means an easy task correctly to trace their proper growth and development. Faraday's investigations covered vast fields in the domain of chemistry, electricity, and magnetism. It is to the last two only that reference here will be made. Faraday's life work in electricity and magnetism began practically in 1831 when he made his immortal discovery of the direct production of electricity from magnetism. His best work in electricity and magnetism was accomplished between 1831 and 1856, extending therefore over a period of some 25 years, although it is not denied that good work was done since 1856. Consequently, it was at so comparatively recent a date that most of Faraday's work was done that some of the world's distinguished electricians yet live who began their studies during the latter years of Faraday's life. The difficulties of tracing, at least to some extent, the influence that Faraday's masterly investigations have had on the present condition of the electrical arts and sciences will, therefore, be considerably lessened. The extent of Faraday's researches and discoveries in magnetism and electricity was so great that it will be impossible, in the necessarily limited space of a brief biographical sketch, to notice any but the more prominent. Nor will any attempt be made, except where the nature of the research or discovery appears to render it advisable, to follow any strict chronological order. For our inquiry here is not so much directed to a mere matter of history as to the influence which the investigation or discovery exerted on the life and civilization of the age in which we live. There is a single discovery of Faraday that stands out sharply amidst all his other discoveries, great as they were, and is so important in its far-reaching results that it alone would have stamped him as a philosophical investigator of the highest merits, had he never done anything else. This was his discovery of the means for developing electricity directly from magnetism. It was made on the 29th of August, 1831, and should be regarded as inspired by the great discovery made by Oersted in 1820 of the relations existing between the voltaic pile and electromagnetism. It was in the same year that Ampere had conducted that memorable investigation as to the mutual attractions and repulsions between circuits through which electric currents are flowing, which resulted in a theory of electromagnetism and finally led to the production of the electromagnet itself. Ampere had shown that a coil of wire, or helix, through which an electric current is passing, acted practically as a magnet, and Arago had magnetized an iron bar by placing it within such a helix. In common with the other scientific men of his time, Faraday believed that since the flow of an electric current invariably produced magnetism, so magnetism should, in its turn, be capable of producing electricity. Many investigators before Faraday's time had endeavored to solve this problem, but it was reserved to Faraday alone to be successful. Since success in this investigation resulted from some experiments he made while endeavoring to obtain inductive action on a quiescent circuit from a neighboring circuit through which an electric current was flowing, we will first briefly examine this experiment. All his experiments in this direction were at first unsuccessful. He passed an electric current through a circuit which was located close to another circuit containing a galvanometer, a device for showing the presence of an electric current and measuring its strength, but failed to obtain a result. He looked for such results only when the current had been fully established in the active circuit. Undismayed by failure, he reasoned that probably effects were present, but that they were too small to be observed owing to the feeble inducing current employed. He therefore increased the strength of the current in the active wire, but still with no results. Again and again he interrogates nature, but unsuccessfully. At last he notices that there is a slight movement of the galvanometer needle at the moment of making and breaking the circuit. Carefully repeating his experiments in light of this observation, he discovers the important fact that it is only at the moment that a current is increasing or decreasing in strength, at the moment of making or breaking a circuit, that the active circuit is capable of producing a current in a neighboring inactive circuit by induction. This was an important discovery, and in the light of his afterknowledge was correctly regarded as a solution of the production of electricity from magnetism. Observing that the galvanometer needle momentarily swings in one direction on making the circuit and in the opposite direction on breaking it, he establishes the fact that the current induced on making flows in the opposite direction to the inducing current, and that induced on breaking flows in the same direction as the inducing current. Having thus established the fact of current induction, he makes the step of substituting magnets for active circuits. A simple step in the light of our present knowledge, but a giant stride at that time. Remembering that current induction, or as he called it, voltaic current induction, takes place only while some effect produced by the current is either increasing or decreasing, he moves coils of insulated wire towards or from magnetic poles, or magnetic poles towards or from coils of wire, and shows that electric currents are generated in the coils while either the coils or the magnets are in motion, but cease to be produced as soon as the motion ceases. Moreover, these magnetically induced currents differ in no respects from other currents, for example, those produced by the voltaic pile, since like the latter they produce sparks, magnetize bars of steel, or deflect the needle of a galvanometer. In this manner, Faraday solved the great problem. He had produced electricity directly from magnetism. With perhaps the single exception of the discovery by Oersted in 1820 of the invariable relation existing between an electric current and magnetism, this study of Faraday may be justly regarded as the greatest in this domain of physical science. These two masterminds in scientific research wonderfully complemented each other. Oersted showed that an electric current is invariably attended by magnetic effects. Faraday showed that magnetic changes are invariably attended by electric currents. Before these discoveries, electricity and magnetism were necessarily regarded as separate branches of physical science and were studied apart as separate phenomena. Now, however, they must be regarded as coexisting phenomena. The ignorance of the scientific world had unwittingly divorced what nature had joined together. In view of the great importance of Faraday's discovery, we shall be justified in inquiring, though somewhat briefly, into some of the apparatus employed in this historic research. Note its extreme simplicity. In one of his first successful experiments, he wraps a coil of insulated wire around the soft iron bar that forms the armature or keeper of a permanent magnet of the horseshoe type, and connects the ends of this coil to a galvanometer. He discovers that whenever the armature is placed against the magnet poles, and is therefore being rendered magnetic by contact therewith, the deflection of the needle of the galvanometer shows that the coiled wire on the armature is transversed by a current of electricity, that whenever the armature is removed from the magnetic poles and is therefore losing its magnetism, the needle of the galvanometer is again deflected, but now in the opposite direction, showing that an electric current is again flowing through the coiled wire on the armature, but reversed in direction. He notices, too, that these effects take place only while changes are going on in the strength of the magnetism in the armature, or when magnetic flux is passing through the coils. For the galvanometer needle comes to rest and remains at rest as long as the contact between the armature and the poles remains unbroken. In another experiment, he employs a simple hollow coil or helix of insulated wire whose ends are connected with a galvanometer. On suddenly thrusting one end of a straight cylindrical magnet into the axis of the helix, the deflection of the galvanometer needle showed the presence of an electric current in the helix. The magnet being left in the helix, the galvanometer needle came to rest, thus showing the absence of current. When the bar magnet was suddenly withdrawn from the helix, the galvanometer needle was again deflected, but now in the opposite direction, showing that the direction of the current in the helix had been reversed. The preceding are but some of the results that Faraday obtained by means of his experimental researches in the direct production of electricity from magnetism. Let us now briefly examine just what he was doing and the means whereby he obtained electric currents for magnetism. We will consider this question from the views of the present time rather than from those of Faraday, although the difference between the two are in most respects immaterial. Faraday knew that the space or region around a magnet is permeated or transversed by what he called magnetic curves, or lines of magnetic force. These lines are still called lines of magnetic force, or by some magnetic streamings, magnetic flux, or simply magnetism. They are invisible, though their presence is readily manifested by means of iron fillings. They are present in every magnet, and although we do not know in which direction they move, yet in order to speak definitely about them, it is agreed to assume that they pass out of every magnet at its north-seeking pole, or the pole which would point to the magnetic north were the magnet free to move as a needle, and after having traversed the space surrounding the magnet, re-enter at its south-seeking pole, thus completing what is called the magnetic circuit. Any space traversed by lines of magnetic force is called a magnetic field. But it is not only a magnet that is thus surrounded by lines of magnetic force or by ether streamings. The same is true of any conductor through which an electric current is flowing, and their presence may be shown by means of iron fillings. If an active conductor, a conductor conveying an electric current, as, for example, a copper wire, be passed vertically through a piece of cardboard or a glass plate, iron fillings dusted on the card or plate will arrange themselves in concentric circles around the axis of the wire. It requires an expenditure of energy both to set up and to maintain these lines of force. It is the interaction of their lines of force that causes the attractions and repulsions in active, movable conductors. These lines of magnetic force act on magnetic needles like other lines of magnetic force and tend to set movable magnetic needles at right angles to the conducting wire. The setting up of an electric current in a conducting wire is therefore equivalent to the setting up of concentric magnetic whirls around the axis of the wire, and anything that can do this will produce an electric current. For example, if an inactive conducting wire is moved through a magnetic field, it will have concentric circular whirls set up around it, or in other words, it will have a current generated in it as a result of such motion. But to set up these whirls, it is not enough that the conducting wire be moved along the lines of force in the field. In such a case, no whirls are produced around the conductor. The conductor must be moved so as to cut or pass through the lines of magnetic force. Just what the mechanism is by means of which the cutting of the lines of force by the conductor produces the circular magnetic whirls around it, no man knows any more than he knows just what electricity is. But this much we do know, that to produce the circular whirls or currents in a previously inactive conductor, the lines of force of some already existing magnetic field must be caused to pass through the conductor, and that the strength of the current so produced is proportional to the number of lines of magnetic force cut in a given time, say per second, or in other words, is directly proportional to the strength of the magnetic field and to the velocity and length of the moving conductor. Or, briefly recapitulating, Oersted showed that an electric current, passed through a conducting circuit, sets up concentric circular whirls around its axis. That is, an electric current invariably produces magnetism. Faraday showed that if the lines of magnetic force or magnetism be caused to cut or pass through an inactive conductor, concentric circular whirls will be set up around the conductor. That is, lines of magnetic force passed across a conductor invariably set up an electric current in that conductor. The wonderful completeness of Faraday's researches into the production of electricity from magnetism may be inferred from the fact that all the forms of magnetoelectric induction known today, namely self-induction, or the induction of an active circuit on itself, mutual induction, or the induction of an active circuit on a neighboring circuit, and electromagnetic induction and magnetoelectric induction, or the induction produced in conductors through which the magnetic flux from electro and permanent magnets respectively is caused to pass, were discovered and investigated by him. Nor were these investigations carried on in the haphazard, blundering, groping manner that unfortunately too often characterizes the explorer in a strange country. On the contrary, they were singularly clear and direct, showing how complete the mastery the great investigator had over the subject he was studying. It is true that repeated failures frequently met him, but despite discouragements and disappointments, he continued until he had entirely traversed the length and breadth of the unknown region he was the first to explore. End of section 23. Section 24 of Beacon Lights of History, Volume 14, The New Era by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Kay Hand. Michael Faraday, Part 2. Let us now briefly examine Faraday's many remaining discoveries and inventions. Though none of these were equal to his great discovery, yet many were exceedingly valuable. Some were almost immediately utilized, some waited many years for utilization, and some have never yet been utilized. We must avoid, however, falling into the common mistake of holding in little esteem those parts of Faraday's work that did not immediately result either in the production of practical apparatus, or in valuable applications in the arts and sciences, or those which have not even yet proved fruitful. Some discoveries and devices are so far ahead of the times in which they are produced, that several lifetimes often pass before the world is ready to utilize them. Like immature or unripe fruit, they are apt to die an untimely death, and it sometimes curiously happens that several generations after their birth, a subsequent inventor or discoverer, in honest ignorance of their prior existence, offers them to the world as absolutely new. The times being ripe, they pass into immediate and extended public use, so that the later inventor is given all the credit of an original discovery, and the true first and original inventor remains unrecognized. We will first examine Faraday's discovery of the relations existing between light and magnetism. Though the discovery has not as yet borne fruit in any direct practical application, yet it has proved of immense value from a theoretical standpoint. In this investigation, Faraday proved that light vibrations are rotated by the action of a magnetic field. He employed the light of an ordinary argand lamp and polarized it by reflection from a glass surface. He caused this polarized light to pass through a plate of heavy glass made from a borosilicate of lead. Under ordinary circumstances, this substance exerted no unusual action on light, but when it was placed between the poles of a powerful electromagnet and the light was passed through it in the same direction as the magnetic flux, the plane of polarization of the light was rotated in a certain direction. Faraday discovered that other solid substances besides glass exert a similar action on a beam of polarized light. Even opaque solids like iron possess this property. Kerr has proved that a beam of light passed through an extremely thin plate of highly magnetic iron has its plane of polarization slightly rotated. Faraday showed that the power of rotating a beam of polarized light is also possessed by some liquids. But what is most interesting, in both solids and liquids, is that the degree of the rotation of the light depends on the direction in which the magnetism is passing, and can, therefore, be changed by changing the polarity of the electromagnet. Faraday did not seem to thoroughly understand this phenomenon. He spoke as if he thought the lines of magnetic force had been rendered luminous by the light rays, for he announced his discovery in a paper entitled Magnetization of Light and the Illumination of the Lines of Magnetic Force. Indeed, this discovery was so far ahead of the times that it was not until a later date that the results were more fully developed, first by Kelvin and subsequently by Clerk Maxwell. In 1865, 2 years before Faraday's death, Maxwell proposed the electromagnetic theory of light, showing that light is an electromagnetic disturbance. He pointed out that optical as well as electromagnetic phenomena required a medium for their propagation, and that the properties of this medium appeared to be the same for both. Moreover, the rate at which light travels is known by actual measurement. The rate at which electromagnetic waves are propagated can be calculated from electrical measurements, and these two velocities exactly agree. Faraday's original experiment as to the relation between light and magnetism is thus again experimentally demonstrated, and Maxwell's electromagnetic theory of light now resting on experimental fact, optics becomes a branch of electricity. A curious consequence was pointed out by Maxwell as a result of his theory, namely that a necessary relation exists between opacity and conductivity, since, as he showed, electromagnetic disturbances could not be propagated in substances which are conductors of electricity. In other words, if a light is an electromagnetic disturbance, all conducting substances must be opaque, and all good insulators transparent. This we know to be the fact. Metallic substances, the best of conductors, are opaque, while glass and crystals are transparent. Even such apparent exceptions as vulcanite, an excellent insulator, fall into the law, since, as Graham Bell has recently shown, this substance is remarkably transparent to certain kinds of radiant energy. In 1778, Brugmans of Leyden noticed that if a piece of bismuth was held near either pole of a strong magnet, repulsion occurred. Other observers noticed the same effect in the case of antimony. These facts appear to have been unknown to Faraday, who in 1845, by employing powerful electromagnets, rediscovered them, and in addition showed that practically all substances possess the power of being attracted or repelled when placed between the poles of sufficiently powerful magnets. By placing slender needles of the substances experimented on between the poles of powerful horseshoe magnets, he found that they were all either attracted like iron, coming to rest with their greatest length extending between the poles, or like bismuth, were apparently repelled by the poles, coming to rest at right angles to the position assumed by iron. He regarded the first class of substances as attracted and the second class as repelled, and called them respectively paramagnetic and diamagnetic substances. In other words, paramagnetic substances like iron came to rest axially, extending from pole to pole, and diamagnetic substances like bismuth equatorially, extending transversely between the poles. He reserved the term magnetic substances to cover the phenomena of both para and diamagnetism. He communicated the results of this investigation to the Royal Society in a paper on the magnetic condition of all matter on December 18, 1845. The properties of paramagnetism and diamagnetism are not possessed by solids only, but exist also in liquids and gases. When experimenting with liquids, they were placed in suitable glass vessels, such as watch crystals, supported on pole pieces properly shaped to receive them. Under these circumstances, paramagnetic liquids, such as salts of iron or cobalt, dissolved in water, underwent curious contortions in shape, the tendency being to arrange the greater part of their mass in the direction in which the flux passed, namely directly between the poles. Diamagnetic liquids, such as solutions of salts of bismuth and antimony, in a similar manner, arrange the greater part of their mass in positions at right angles to this direction, or equatorially. At first, Faraday attributed the repulsion of diamagnetic substances to a polarity, separate and distinct from ordinary magnetic polarity, for which he proposed the name diamagnetic polarity. He believed that when a diamagnetic substance is brought near to the north pole of a magnet, a north pole was developed in its approached end, and therefore repulsion occurred. He afterwards rejected this view, though it has been subsequently adopted by Weber and Tyndall, the latter of whom conducted an extended series of experiments on the subject. The majority of physicists, however, at the present time, do not believe in the existence of a diamagnetic polarity. They point out that the apparent repulsion of diamagnetic substances is due to the fact that they are less paramagnetic than the oxygen of the air in which they are suspended. During this investigation, Faraday observed some phenomena that led him to a belief in the existence of another form of force, distinct from either paramagnetic or diamagnetic force, which he called the magna crystallic force. He had been experimenting with some slender needles of bismuth, suspending them horizontally between the poles of an electromagnet. Taking a few of these cylinders at random from a greater number, he was much perplexed to find that they did not all come to rest equatorially, as well-behaved bars of diamagnetic bismuth should do. Though, if subjected to the action of a single magnetic pole, they did show this diamagnetic character by their marked repulsion. After much experimentation, he ascribed this phenomenon to the crystalline condition of the cylinder. By experimenting with carefully selected groups of crystals of bismuth, he believed he could trace the cause of the phenomenon to the action of a force which he called the magna crystallic force. Extended experiments carried on by Plücker on the influence of magnetism on crystalline substances led him to believe that a close relation exists between the ultimate forms of the particles of matter and their magnetic behavior. This subject is as yet far from being fully understood. There was another series of investigations made by Faraday between the years 1831 and 1840 that has been wonderfully utilized and may properly be ranked among his great discoveries. We allude to his researches on the laws which govern the chemical decomposition of compound substances by electricity. The fact that the electric current possesses the power of decomposing compound substances was known as early as 1800, when Carlyle and Nicholson separated water into its constituent elements by the passage of a voltaic current. Davy, too, in 1806, had delivered his celebrated discourse on some chemical agencies of electricity, and in 1807 had announced his great discovery of the decomposition of the fixed alkalis. Faraday showed that the amount of chemical action produced by electricity is fixed and definite. In order to be able to measure the amount of this action, he invented an instrument which he called a voltmeter, or a voltaelectrometer. It consisted of a simple device for measuring the amount of hydrogen and oxygen gases liberated by the passage of an electric current through water acidulated with sulfuric acid. He showed by numerous experiments that the decomposition affected is invariably proportional to the amount of electricity passing, that variations in the size of the electrodes, in the pressure, or in the degree of dilution of the electrolyte had nothing to do with the result, and that, therefore, a voltmeter could be employed to determine the amount of electricity passing in a given circuit. He also demonstrated that when a current is passed through different electrolytes, compound substances decomposed by the passage of electricity, the amount of the decompositions are chemically equivalent to each other. The extent of Faraday's work in the electrochemical field may be judged by considering some of the terms he proposed for its phenomena, most of which, with some trifling exceptions, are still in use. It was he who gave the name electrolysis to decomposition by the electric current. He also proposed to call the wires or conductors connected with the battery or other electric sources the electrodes, naming that one which was connected to the positive terminal the anode, and that one connected with the negative terminal the cathode. He called the separate atoms or groups of atoms into which bodies undergoing electrolysis are separated the radicals or ions, and named the electropositive ions, which appear at the cathodes, the cations, and the electronegative radicals, which appear at the anodes, the anions. There were many other researches made by Faraday, such as his experiments on disruptive electric discharges, his investigations of the electric eel, his many researches on the phenomena both of frictional electricity and of the voltaic pile, his investigations on the contact and chemical theories of the voltaic pile, and those on chemical decomposition by frictional electricity. These are but some of the more important of them. Those we have already discussed will, however, amply suffice to show the value of his work. Rather than take up any others, let us inquire what influence, if any, the various groups of discoveries we have already discussed have exerted on the electric arts and sciences in our present time. What practical results have attended these discoveries? What actual, useful, commercial machines have been based on them? What useful processes or industries have grown out of them? And first, as to actual commercial machines. These researches not only led to the production of dynamo electric machines, but, in point of fact, Faraday actually produced the first dynamo. A dynamo electric machine, as is well known, is a machine by means of which mechanical energy is converted into electrical energy by causing conductors to cut through, or be cut through by, lines of magnetic force. Or briefly, it is a machine by means of which electricity is readily obtained from magnetism. Faraday's invention of the first dynamo is interesting because at the same time he made the invention, he solved a problem which up to his time had been the despair of the ablest physicists and mathematicians. This was the phenomenon of Arago's rotating disc. It was briefly as follows. If a copper disc be rotated above a magnet, the needle tends to follow the plate in its rotation. Or if a copper plate be placed at rest above or below an oscillating magnet, it tends to check its oscillations and bring the needle quickly to rest. Faraday investigated these phenomena and soon discovered that a copper disc rotated below two magnet poles had electric currents generated in it, which flowed radially through the disc between its circumference and center. By placing one end of a conducting circuit on the axis of the disc and the other on its circumference, he succeeded in drawing off a continuous electric current generated from magnetism, and thus produced the first dynamo. This was in 1831. Faraday produced many other dynamos besides this simple disc machine. Although the disc dynamo in its original form was impracticable as a commercial machine, yet it was not only the forerunner of the dynamo, but was, in point of fact, the first machine ever produced that is entitled to be called a dynamo. He generously left to those who might come after him the opportunity to avail themselves of his wonderful discovery. "I have rather, however," he says, "been desirous of discovering new facts and new relations dependent on magneto-electric induction than of the exalting force of those already obtained, being assured that the latter would find their development hereafter." How profoundly prophetic! Could the illustrious investigator see the hundreds of thousands of dynamos that are today in all parts of the world engaged in converting millions of horsepower of mechanical energy into electric energy, he would appreciate how marvelously his successors have exalted the force of some of the effects he had so ably shown the world how to obtain. Faraday lived to see his infant dynamo, the first of its kind, developed into a machine not only sufficiently powerful to maintain electric arc lights, but also into a form sufficiently practicable to be continuously engaged in producing such light in one of the lighthouses on the English coast. Holmes produced such a machine in 1862, or some years before Faraday's death. It was installed under the care of the Trinity House at the Dungeness Lighthouse in June 1862 and continued in use for about 10 years. When this machine was shown to Faraday by its inventor, the veteran philosopher remarked, "I gave you a baby, and you bring me a giant." The alternating current transformer is another gift of Faraday to the commercial world. As is well known, this instrument is a device for raising or lowering electric pressure. The name is derived from the fact that the instrument is capable of taking in at one pressure the electric energy supplied to it and giving it out at another pressure, thus transforming it. Faraday produced the first transformer during his investigations on voltaic current induction. The modern alternating current transformer, though differing markedly in minor details from Faraday's primitive instrument, yet in general details is essentially identical with it. The enormous use of both step-up and step-down transformers, transformers which respectively induce currents of higher and of lower electromotive forces in their secondary coils than are passed through their primaries, shows the great practical value of this invention. The wonderful growth of the commercial applications of alternating currents during the past few decades would have been impossible without the use of the alternating current transformer. It is an interesting fact that it was not in the form of the step-down alternating current transformer that Faraday's discovery of voltaic current induction was first utilized, but in the form of a step-up transformer, or what was then ordinarily called an induction coil. As early as 1842, Masson and Bruget constructed an induction coil by means of which minute sparks could be obtained from the secondary in vacuo. In 1851, Ruhmkorff constructed an induction coil so greatly improved by the careful insulation of its secondary circuit that he could obtain from it torrents of long sparks in ordinary air. The Ruhmkorff induction coil has in late years been greatly improved both by Tesla and Elihu Thomson, who, separately and independently of each other, have produced excellent forms of high-frequency induction coils. Induction coils have long been in use for purposes of research and in later years have been employed in the production both of the Röntgen rays used in the photography of the invisible and the electromagnetic waves used in wireless telegraphy. Röntgen's discovery was published in 1895. It was rendered possible by the prior work of Geissler and Crookes on the luminous phenomena produced by the passage of electric discharges through high vacua in glass tubes. Röntgen discovered that the invisible rays, or radiation, emitted from certain parts of a high vacuum tube when high tension discharges from induction coils were passing, possessed the curious property of traversing certain opaque substances as readily as light does glass or water. He also discovered that these rays were capable of exciting fluorescence in some substances, that is, of causing them to emit light and become luminous, and that these rays, like the rays of light, were capable of affecting a photographic plate. From these properties, two curious possibilities arose, namely, to see through opaque bodies, and to photograph the invisible. Röntgen called these rays X, or unknown rays. They are now almost invariably called by the name of their distinguished discoverer. Let us briefly investigate how it is possible both to see and to photograph the invisible. Shortly after Röntgen's discovery, Edison, with that wonderful power of finding practical applications for nearly all discoveries, had invented the fluoroscope, a screen covered with a peculiar chemical substance that becomes luminous when exposed to the Röntgen rays. Suppose now between the rays and such a screen could be interposed a substance opaque to ordinary light, as, for example, the human hand. The tissues of the hand, such as the flesh and the blood, permit the rays to readily pass through them, but the bones are opaque to the rays and therefore oppose their passage. Consequently, the screen, instead of being uniformly illumined, will show shadows of bones, so that, to an eye examining the screen, it will seem as though it were looking through the flesh and blood directly at the bones. In a similar manner, if a photographic plate be employed instead of the screen, a distinct photographic picture will be obtained. Both the fluoroscope and the photographic camera have proved an invaluable aid to the surgeon, who can now look directly through the human body and examine its internal organs, and so be able to locate such foreign bodies as bullets and needles in its various parts, or make correct diagnoses of fractures or dislocations of the bones, or even examine the action of such organs as the liver and heart. About 1886, Hertz discovered that if a small Leyden jar is discharged through a short and simple circuit, provided with a spark gap of suitable length, a series of electromagnetic waves are set up, which, moving through space in all directions, are capable of exciting in a similar circuit effects which can be readily recognized, although the two circuits are at fairly considerable distances apart. Here we have a simple, basic experiment in wireless telegraphy, which, briefly considered, consists of means whereby oscillations or waves, set up in free spaces by means of disruptive discharges, are caused to traverse space and produce various effects in suitably constructed receptive devices that are operated by the waves as they impinge on them. At first, a doubt was expressed by eminent scientific men as to the practicability of successfully transmitting wireless messages through long distances, since these waves, traveling in all directions, would soon become too attenuated to produce intelligible signals. But when it was shown, from theoretical considerations, that these waves, when traversing great distances, are practically confined to the space between the Earth's surface and the upper rarefied strata of the atmosphere, the possibility of long-distance wireless telegraphic transmission was recognized. To increase the distance, it was only necessary either to increase the energy of the waves at the transmitting station, or to increase the delicacy of the receiving instruments, or both. It has been but a short time since both the scientific and the financial worlds were astounded by the actual transmissions of intelligible wireless signals across the Atlantic, and the name of Marconi will go down to posterity as the one who first accomplished this great feat. The principal limit to the distance of transmission lies in the delicacy of the receiving instruments. The most sensitive are those in which a telephone receiver forms a part of the receiving apparatus. The almost incredibly small amount of electric energy required to produce intelligible speak in an ordinary Bell telephone receiver nearly passes belief. The work done in lifting such an instrument from its hook to the ear of the listener would, if converted into electric energy, be sufficient to maintain an audible sound in a telephone for 240,000 years. Even extremely attenuated waves may therefore produce audible signals in such a receiver. End of section 24. Section 25 of Beacon Lights of History, Volume 14, The New Era, by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Kay Hand. Michael Faraday, Part 3. The electric motor was another gift of Faraday to commercial science, although in this case there are others who can, perhaps, justly claim to share the honor with him. Faraday's early electric motor consisted essentially in a device whereby a movable conductor, suspended so as to be capable of rotation around a magnet pole, was caused to rotate by the mutual interaction of the magnetic fields of the active conductor and the magnet. The magnet, which consisted of a bar of hardened steel, was fixed in a cork stopper which completely closed the end of an upright glass tube. A small quantity of mercury was placed in the lower end of the tube so as to form a liquid contact for the lower end of a movable wire, suspended so as to be capable of rotating at its lower extremity about the axis of the tube. On the passage of an electric current through the wire, a continuous rotary motion was produced in it, the direction of which depends both on the direction of the current and on the polarity of the end of the magnet around which the rotation occurs. The great value of the electric motor to the world is too evident to need any proof. The number of purposes for which electric motors are now employed is so great that the actual number of motors in daily use is almost incredible, and every year sees this number rapidly increasing. The above are the more important machines or devices that have been directly derived from Faraday's great investigation as to the production of electricity from magnetism. Let us now inquire briefly as to what useful processes or industries have been rendered possible by the existence of these machines. Apparently, one of the most marked requirements of our 20th century civilization is that man shall be readily able to extend the day far into the night. He can no longer go to sleep when the sun sets and keep abreast with his competitors. Of all the artificial illuminants yet employed, the arc and the incandescent electric lights are unquestionably the best, whether from a sanitary, aesthetic, or truest economical standpoint. Now, while it is a well-known matter of record that both arc and incandescent lights were invented long before Faraday's time, yet it was not until a source of electricity was invented, superior both in economy and convenience to the voltaic battery, that either of these lights became commercial possibilities. Such an electric source was given to the world by Faraday through his invention of the dynamo electric machine, and it was not until this machine was sufficiently developed and improved that commercial electric lighting became possible. The energy of burning coal through the steam engine working the dynamo is far cheaper and more efficient for producing electricity than the consumptions of metals through the voltaic pile. It is characteristic of the modesty of Faraday that when, in after life, he heard inventors speaking of their electric lights, he refrained from claiming the electric light as his own, although without the machine he taught the world how to construct, commercial lighting would have been an impossibility. The marvelous activity in the electric arts and sciences, which followed as a natural result of Faraday giving to the world in the dynamo electric machine a cheap electric source, naturally leads to the inquiry as to whether at a somewhat later day a yet greater revolution may not follow the production of a still cheaper electric source. In point of fact, such a discovery is by no means an impossibility. When a dynamo electric machine is caused to produce an electric current by the intervention of a steam engine, the transformation of energy which takes place from the energy of the coal to electric energy is an extremely wasteful one. Could some practical method be discovered by means of which the burning of coal liberates electric energy instead of heat energy, an electric source would be discovered that would far exceed in economy the best dynamo in existence. With such a discovery, what the result would be, no one can say. This much is certain, that it would, among other things, relegate the steam engine to the scrap heap and solve the problem of aerial navigation. What is justly regarded as one of the greatest achievements of modern times is the electrical transmission of power over comparatively great distances. At some cheap source of energy, say at a waterfall, a water wheel is employed to drive a dynamo or generator, thus converting mechanical energy into electrical energy. This electricity is passed over a conducting line to a distant station, where it is either directly utilized for the purpose of lighting, heating, chemical decomposition, etc., or indirectly utilized for the purpose of obtaining mechanical power for driving machinery by passing it through an electric motor. The electric transmission of power has been successfully made in California over a distance of some 220 miles at a pressure on transmission lines of 50,000 volts. The high pressures required for the economical use of transmission lines necessitates the employment of transformers at each end of the line, namely step-up transformers at the transmitting end to raise the voltage delivered by the generators, and step-down transformers at the receiving end to lower it for use in the various translating devices. These transformers are employed in connection with alternating current dynamos. Faraday not only gave to the world the first electric generator, but also the first transformer, and one of the first electric motors, and without these gifts, the electric transmission of power over long distances, which has been justly regarded as one of the most marvelous achievements of our age, would have been an impossibility. In high-tension circuits, over which such pressures as 50,000 volts is transmitted, no little difficulty is experienced from leakage and consequent loss of energy. This leakage occurs both between the line conductors and at the insulators placed on the pole lines forming the line circuit. The insulators are made either of glass or porcelain and are of a peculiar form known as triple petticoat pattern. The loss on such lines due to leakage between wires is greater than that which takes place at the pole insulators and is diminished by keeping the circuit wires as far apart as possible. In the early history of the art, electric transmission of power was effected by means of direct current generators and motors. Generators and motors through which the current always passed in the same direction. Such generators and motors, however, possessed inconveniences that prevented extensive commercial transmission of power, since, as we have seen, high pressure was necessary for efficiency in such transmission, and the collecting brushes and commutators employed in all direct current generators and motors to carry the current from the machine or into the motor were a constant source of trouble and danger. When the alternating current motor first came into general use, it was employed in connection with the alternating current generator in electric transmission systems. But such motors also possess the inconvenience of not readily starting from a state of rest with their full turning power or torque, and of therefore being unsuitable where the motor requires to be frequently stopped or started. Had these difficulties remained unsolved, long-distance electric transmission of power, so successful in operation today, and which bids fair to be still more successful in the near future, would have been impossible. Fortunately, these difficulties were overcome by the genius of Nikola Tesla in the invention of the multi-phase alternating current motor, or the induction motor, as it is now generally called. Although Bailey, Deprez, and Ferraris had accomplished much before Tesla's time, yet it was practically to the investigations and discoveries made by Tesla between 1887 and 1891 that the induction motor of today is due. Another requirement of our 20th century civilization is rapid transit, either urban or interurban, and this is afforded by various systems of electric street railways or electric traction generally, including electric locomotives and electric automobiles. The wonderful growth in this direction, which has been witnessed in the last few decades, would have been impossible without the electric generator and motor, both gifts of Faraday to the world. Their application in this direction must, therefore, go to swell the debt our civilization owes to the labors of this great investigator. In the system of electric streetcar propulsion, very generally employed today, a single trolley wheel is employed for taking the driving current from an overhead conductor suspended above the street. The trolley wheel is supported by a trolley pole and is maintained in good electric contact with the trolley wire or overhead conductor. By this means, the current passes from the wire down the conductor connected with the trolley pole, thence through the motors placed below the body of the car, and from them through the track or ground return back to the power station. A small portion of the current is employed for lighting the electric lamps in the car. In some systems, an underground trolley is employed. An important device, called the series parallel controller, is employed in all systems of electric streetcar propulsion. It consists of means by which the starting and stopping of the car, and changes both in its speed and direction, are placed under the control of the motorman. A separate controller is placed on both platforms of the car. The series parallel controller consists essentially of a switch by means of which the several motors that are employed in all streetcars can be variously connected with each other, or with different electric resistances, or can be successively cut out or introduced into the circuit, so that the speed of the car can be regulated at will, as the handle of the controller is moved by the motorman to the various notches on the top of the controller box. As generally arranged, the speed increases from the first notch or starting position to the last notch, movements in the opposite direction changing connections in the opposite order of succession and therefore slowing the car. There is, however, no definite speed corresponding to each notch, for this will vary with the load on each car and with the gradient upon which it may be running. But there is another valuable gift received by the world as a result of this great discovery of Faraday, namely, that most marvelous instrument of modern times, the speaking telephone. This instrument was invented in 1861 by Philip Reese and subsequently independently reinvented in 1876 by Elisha Gray and Alexander Graham Bell. As is well known, it is electric currents and not sound waves that are transmitted over a telephone circuit. The magneto-electric telephone, in its simplest form, consists of a pair of instruments called, respectively, the transmitter and the receiver. We talk into the transmitter and listen at the receiver. Both transmitter and receiver consist of a permanent magnet of hardened steel around one end of which is placed a coil of insulated wire. In front of this coil, a diaphragm or thin plate of soft iron is so supported as to be capable of freely vibrating towards and from the magnetic pole. The operation of the transmitting instrument is readily understood in the light of Faraday's discovery. It is simply a dynamo electric machine driven by the voice of the speaker. As the sound waves from the speaker's voice strike against the diaphragm, which has become magnetic from its nearness to the magnet pole, electric currents are generated in the coil of wire surrounding such pole, since the to and fro motions cause the lines of electromagnetic force to pass through the wire on the moving coil. The operation of the receiving instrument is also readily understood. It acts as an electric motor driven by the to and fro currents generated by the transmitters. As these currents are transmitted over the wire, they pass through the coil of wire on the receiving instrument and reproduce therein the exact movement of the transmitting diaphragm, since as they strengthen or weaken the magnetism of the pole, they cause similar motions in the diaphragm placed before it. Consequently, one listening at the receiving diaphragm will hear all that is uttered into the transmitting diaphragm. It was thus, by the combination of the dynamo and motor, both of which were given by Faraday to the world, that we have received this priceless instrument, which has been so potent in its effects on the civilization of the 20th century. The electric telegraph had its beginnings long before Faraday's time. As early as 1847, Watson had erected a line some 2 miles in length, extending over the housetops in London, and operated it by means of discharges from an ordinary frictional electric machine. In 1774, Lesage had erected in Geneva an electric telegraph consisting of a number of metallic wires, one for each letter of the alphabet. These wires were carefully insulated from each other. When a message was to be sent over this early telegraphic line, an electric discharge was passed through the particular wire representing the letter of the alphabet to be sent. This discharge, reaching the other end, caused a pithball to be repelled, and thus laboriously, letter by letter, the message was transmitted. How ludicrously cumbersome was such an instrument when contrasted with the Morse electromagnetic telegraph of today, which requires but a single wire, or with the harmonic telegraph of Gray, which permits the simultaneous transmissions of 8 or more separate messages over a single wire, or with the wonderful quadruplex telegraphic system of Edison, which permits the simultaneous transmission of 4 separate and distinct messages over a single wire, 2 in one direction and 2 in the opposite direction at the same time. Or with the still more wonderful multiplex telegraph of Delaney, which is able to simultaneously transmit as many as 72 separate messages over a single wire, 36 in one direction and 36 in the opposite direction. These achievements have been possible only through the researches and discoveries of Oersted, Faraday, and host of other eminent workers. For it was the electromagnet rendered possible by Oersted, together with the magnificent discoveries of Faraday and others since his time, that these marvelous advances in the electrotelegraphic transmission of intelligence have become possibilities. Before completing this brief sketch of some of the effects that Faraday's work has had on the practical arts and sciences, let us briefly examine the generating plants that are either in operation or construction at Niagara Falls. Some idea of the size of the Niagara Falls generating plant on the American side may be gained from the fact that there have already been installed 11 of the separate 5,000 horsepower generators. The remaining capacity of the tunnel will permit of the installation of 50,000 additional horsepower, or 105,000 horsepower in all. On the Canadian side of the falls, another great plant is about to be erected with an ultimate capacity of several hundred thousand horsepower. Here, however, the size of the generating unit will be double that on the American side, or 10,000 horsepower. These generators will be wound to produce an electric pressure of 12,000 volts, raised by means of step-up transformers to 22,000, 40,000, and 60,000 volts, according to the distance of transmission. Each of the revolving parts of these machines will weigh 141,000 pounds. To what gigantic proportions has the little infant dynamo of Faraday grown in this short time since its birth? The low rates at which electric power can be sold in the immediate neighborhood of the Niagara generating plant have naturally resulted in an enormous growth of the electrochemical industries, for these industries could never otherwise develop into extended commercial applications. Of the total output of, say, 55,000 horsepower at the Niagara Falls generating plant, no less than 23,200 horsepower is used in various electrolytic and electrothermal processes in the immediate neighborhood. Some of the more important consumers of the electric power, named in the order of consumption, are for the manufacture of the following products: calcium carbide, aluminum, caustic soda and bleaching salt, carborundum, and graphite. Calcium carbide, employed in the production of acetylene gas, either for the purposes of artificial illumination or for the manufacture of ethyl alcohol, is produced by subjecting a mixture of carbon and lime to the prolonged action of heat in an electric furnace. Aluminum, the now well-known valuable metal present in clay, bauxite, and a variety of other mineral substances, is electrolytically deposited from a bath of alumina obtained by dissolving bauxite in either potassium, fluoride, or in cryolite. Aluminum is now coming into extended use in the construction of long-distance electric power transmission lines. Caustic soda and bleaching salt are produced by the electrolytic decomposition of brine, chloride of sodium. The chlorine liberated at the anode is employed in the manufacture of bleaching salt, and the sodium is liberated at a mercury cathode, with which it at once enters into combination as an alloy. On throwing this alloy into water, the sodium is liberated as caustic soda. Carborundum, a silicide of carbon, is a valuable substance produced by the action of the heat of an electric furnace on an intimate mixture of carbon and sand. It has an extensive use as an abrasive for grinding and polishing. Artificial graphite is another product produced by the long-continued action of the heat of the electric furnace on carbon under certain conditions. According to reports from the United States Geological Survey, the graphite works at Niagara Falls produced in 1901 2,500,000 pounds of artificial graphite valued at $119,000. This was an increase from 860,270 pounds valued at $69,860 for 1900, and from 162,382 pounds valued at $10,140 in 1897, the first year of its commercial production. In 1901, more than half of the output was in the form of graphitized electrodes employed in the production of caustic soda and bleaching salt and in other electrolytic processes. The Niagara Falls power transmission system stands today as a magnificent testimonial to the genius of Faraday and as a living monument of the varied and valuable gifts his researches have bestowed upon mankind. For here we have not only the dynamo, motors, and transformers that he gave freely to the world, not only the alternating current transformer and the system of transmission of power, but we even find that the principal consumers of the enormous electric power produced are employing it in carrying on some of the many processes in electrochemistry, a science that he had done so much to advance. Among some of the surprises electrochemistry may have in store for the world in the comparatively near future may be a nearer approach to a mastery of the laws which govern the combination of elementary substances when under the influence of plant life. If these laws ever become so well known that man is able to form in his laboratory the various food products that are now formed naturally in plant organisms, such a revolution would be wrought that the work of the agriculturalist would be largely transferred to the electrochemist. Some little has already been done in the direct formation of some vegetable substances, such as camphor, the peculiar flavoring substance present in the vanilla bean, and in many other substances. Should such discoveries ever reach to the direct formation of some food staple, the wide-reaching importance and significance of the discovery would be almost beyond comprehension. But while the direct electrosynthetic formation of food products is yet to be accomplished on a practical scale, the problem appears to be nearing actual solution in an indirect manner. It has been known since the time of Cavendish in 1785 that small quantities of nitric acid could be formed directly from the nitrogen and oxygen of the atmosphere by the passage of electric sparks. But heretofore, the quantity so found has been too small to be of any commercial value. Quite recently, however, one of the electrochemical companies at Niagara Falls has succeeded in commercially solving the important problem of the fixation of the nitrogen of the atmosphere. It being claimed that the cost of thus producing 1 ton of commercial nitric acid, of a market value of over $80, does not greatly exceed $20. Since sodium nitrate can readily be produced by the process, and its value as a fertilizer of wheat fields is too well known to need comment, there would thus, to a limited extent, be indirectly solved the electrochemical production of food staples. Faraday's high rank as an investigator in the domain of natural science was fully recognized by the learned societies of his time by admission into their fellowships. As early as 1824, he was honored by the Royal Society of London by election as one of its fellows, and in 1825, he had become a member of the Royal Institution. It is recorded of the great philosopher that the membership in the Royal Institution was the only one which he personally sought. All others came unsought. But they came so rapidly from all portions of the globe that in 1844 he was a member of no less than 70 of the leading learned societies of the world. Rees, the German electrician, so well known in connection with his invention of the speaking telephone, addressed Faraday as Professor Michael Faraday, member of all the academies. Besides his membership in the learned societies, Faraday received numerous degrees from the colleges and universities of his time. Among some of these are the following. The University of Prague, the degree of PhD, Oxford, the degree of DCL, and Cambridge, the degree of LLD. He also received numerous medals of honor and was offered the presidency of the Royal Society, which, however, he declined, as he did also a knighthood proffered by the government of England. Faraday died on the 25th of August, 1867, after a long, well-spent, useful life. We have thus briefly traced some of the more important discoveries of Michael Faraday. Many have necessarily been passed by, but what we have given are more than sufficient to stamp him as a great philosopher and investigator. Speaking of Faraday in this connection, Professor Tyndall says, "Take him for all in all. I think it will be conceded that Michael Faraday is the greatest experimental philosopher the world has ever seen, and I will add the opinion that the progress of future research will tend not to diminish or decrease, but to enhance and glorify the labors of this mighty investigator." Authorities. Experimental Researches in Electricity by Michael Faraday from the Philosophical Transactions. Abstracts of the Philosophical Transactions from 1800 to 1837. Faraday's Experimental Researches in Electricity and Magnetism, 3 volumes. Life and Letters of Faraday by Dr. Bence Jones. Michael Faraday by J. H. Gladstone. Student's Textbook of Electricity by Henry M. Node, revised by W. H. Preece. Michael Faraday by John Tyndall. Pioneers of Electricity by J. Monroe. Dynamo Electric Machinery by Sylvanus P. Thompson. A Dictionary of Electrical Words, Terms, and Phrases by Edwin J. Houston. Electricity and Magnetism by Edwin J. Houston. Electricity 100 Years Ago and Today by Edwin J. Houston. Magnetism, Electrotechnical Series by Edwin J. Houston and Arthur E. Kennelly. Electrodynamic Machinery by Edwin J. Houston and A. E. Kennelly. End of section 25. Section 26 of Beacon Lights of History, Volume 14, The New Era by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by K. Hand. Rudolf Virchow, Part 1. 1821 to 1902. Medicine and Surgery, by Frank P. Foster, M.D. Stagnation was the state of medicine when the 19th century opened. It was only 3 years before that Jenner had announced and demonstrated the protective efficacy of vaccination against smallpox. His teaching, in spite of the vehement cavillings of the antis of his day, gained credence readily, and vaccination speedily became recognized and was constantly resorted to. But hardly any attempt at perfecting the practice was made until after more than 50 years had elapsed. His discovery, or rather his proof of the truth of a rustic tradition, fell like a pebble into the doldrums. The ripple soon subsided, and nobody was encouraged to start another. At the present time, such an announcement would be promptly followed by investigations leading up to such doctrines as that of the attenuation of viruses and that of antitoxins. But the times were not ripe for anything of that sort. Medicine reposed on tradition, or at best gave itself only to such plausibilities in the way of innovation as were cleverly advocated. Physicians strove not to advance the healing art. As individuals, they were content to rely on their manners, their tact, and their assumption of wisdom. In short, the body medical was in a state of suspended animation, possessed of a mere vegetative existence. The humoral pathology, or that doctrine of the nature of disease which ascribed all ailments to excess, deficiency, or ill concoction of some one of the four humors, yellow and black bile, blood and phlegm, had not yet lost its hold on men's convictions, or at least not further than to make them look upon exposure to cold and errors of diet as amply explanatory of all diseases not plainly infectious. The medical writers who were most revered were those who busied themselves with nosology, that is to say, the naming and classifying of diseases. Wonderful were the onomatological feats performed by some of these men, and most diverse and grotesque were the data on which they founded their classifications. To label a disease was high art. To cure it was something that Providence might or might not allow. In the treatment of sthenic acute diseases, meaning those accompanied by excitement and high fever, bloodletting, mercury given to the point of salivation, antimony, and opium, together with starvation, all included under the euphemism of lowering measures, were the means universally resorted to and reputed sheet anchors. Some advance had been made from the times when disease had been looked upon as an entity to be exorcised, but it was still so far regarded as a material thing that it was to be starved out. But the century was not out of its second decade when signs of an awaking from this lethargy began to show themselves. The first steps naturally were along preparatory lines, and for those we are largely indebted to the physicists, the chemists, and the botanists. Gross anatomy became better known, owing for the most part to more enlightened legislation on the subject of the dissection of the human body. Minute anatomy, histology, sprang into existence as the result of improvements of the compound microscope. Physiology took on something of the experimental, and medication was rendered far less gross and repulsive by the isolation of the active principles of medicinal plants. But it was long after all this that the telling strides were taken. Up to within the memory of many men who are now living, peritonitis tortured its victims to death, said peritonitis being often interpreted as a manifestation of rheumatism, for example, and no well-directed interposition was attempted against it. Whereas we now know perfectly well that the vast majority of cases of peritonitis are due to local septic poisoning, and for the most part quite readily remediable by the removal, with a minimum of danger, of the organ from which such poisoning arises, almost always the vermiform appendix. Appendicitis, of which we hear so much nowadays, is no new disease. It is simply the peritonitis that killed so many people in former times. But while no well-informed person would now maintain that this disease was a new one, there are many, and those too among the best instructed, who find it difficult to avoid the conclusion that if not new, it must at least be of far more frequent occurrence than formerly. It must be borne in mind, however, that in the great majority of instances in the past years, it ended spontaneously in recovery and was forgotten. Two features of the progress in medicine in the 19th century, negative as they may seem to have been, were undoubtedly potent in the promotion of advance. They were the recognition of the fact that many dangerous diseases are self-limited and the experiment of the so-called expectant treatment. The result of the first of them was to teach men to desist from futile attempts to cure the self-limited diseases, in the sense of cutting them short in their course, and the expectant treatment followed as a natural consequence. It was a method of managing disease rather than attempting to cure it. There was no interference save to promote the patient's comfort, to nourish him as thoroughly as might be without unduly taxing his powers, and to meet complications as they arose. It was stooping to conquer, perhaps, but it was a policy that conduced greatly to the well-being of the sick, improved their chances of recovery, and enabled physicians to study disease more accurately by reason of its course not being rendered irregular by meddlesome medication. It has never been dropped, and never will be, save as such directly curative agents as antitoxins are made available. In the early part of the century, except for gross anatomy and operative surgery, medicine was taught almost wholly, so far as the schools were concerned, by means of didactic lectures. The drawing capacity of a professor was proportionate rather to his rhetorical powers and to the persuasiveness with which he inculcated the views peculiar to himself than to the amount of real information he conveyed to the students. Although the apprentice system, for that was what the practice of students attaching themselves to individual practitioners, whom they called their preceptors, virtually amounted to, in many instances made up more or less completely for the lack of systematic clinical teaching. Yet in the great majority of cases, it amounted to little more than the preceptors allowing the student the use of his library and occasionally examining into the latter's diligence and intelligence, in return for which he, the preceptor, required an annual fee and exacted from the student such minor services as his proficiency enabled him to render. It is true, the students walked the hospitals, drinking in some great man's utterances, but they did it in droves, not a moiety of them being able to get a good look at a patient, unless it was such a passing glance as might tell them that the patient was jaundiced. By clinical teaching, we understand teaching, not in glittering generalities, but in the concrete, either at the bedside, as the word clinical originally implied, or at least with the patient actually present to illustrate in his person the professor's descriptions and the success or failure of the treatment employed. The clinic is now firmly established and has been for years, but it was long before this grand result was attained. Experimental methods of study gradually came into vogue, particularly in the domain of physiology. In this sphere, Dr. William Beaumont of the United States Army was a pioneer. His historic experiments on Alexis St. Martin, a soldier who had been wounded in the stomach and recovered with a permanent opening into that organ, will ever rank among the most important of the early experimental studies of digestion. It was not long before Claude Bernard extended similar inquiries to the other functions of the body, notably those of the nervous system. And since his time, there has been a long array of brilliant investigators of physiology and of other branches of science tributary to medicine. Experiments on living animals were almost the only means of carrying on these researches. In the early days, the animals employed were doubtless put to a great deal of pain, perhaps in many instances to unnecessary suffering, and an altogether laudable feeling of humanity has led good people to band themselves together for the purpose of putting a stop to vivisection, or at least of greatly restricting the practice and of freeing it from all avoidable infliction of pain. These praiseworthy efforts have in some instances been carried so far, unfortunately, as to seriously hamper scientific investigation. Investigation which has for its object the alleviation of human suffering and the saving of human life. We may earnestly deprecate and strive to prevent wanton reiteration of painful experiments for purposes of demonstrating anew that which is unquestioned, and we may resort to all possible means to render necessary experiments free from actual pain. From the anguish of trepidation, we can seldom relieve the poor animals. But let us not block the wheels of scientific progress. At the dawn of the 19th century, to examine a sick person's pulse, to inspect his tongue, to observe his breathing, to interrogate his skin by our sense of touch, and to try to make his statements and those of his friends fit in with some tenable theory of the nature of his ailment, were about all we could do. Possibly it was because he realized to an uncommon degree the tremendous impediment of this narrow limitation that Samuel Hahnemann, the founder of homeopathy, cut the Gordian knot in sheer rebelliousness and proclaimed, as he virtually did, that a diagnosis was not necessary to the successful treatment of disease, but that one only needed to know empirically how to subdue symptoms, meaning mainly, if not solely, what we term subjective symptoms, those of which the patient complains, as opposed to those that we ourselves discover. But the physical examination of the sick, before extremely meager in its sphere and restricted in its possibilities, was destined to expand before many years into the minute and positive physical diagnosis of the present day. In the year 1816, a French physician, René Théophile Hyacinthe Laennec, achieved undying fame by publishing to the world an account of his labors in the application of mediate auscultation and of percussion to the diagnosis of the diseases of the chest. It is true that no less a personage than the father of medicine, Hippocrates, is reputed to have practiced succussion as a means of diagnosis, that is, the shaking of a patient as one would shake a cask, to ascertain by the occurrence or non-occurrence of a splashing sound if the person's pleural cavity was distended partly with water and partly with air. It is probable that Hippocrates and many others after him carried the physical examination of the chest still further, for it is difficult to imagine, for example, that so simple a device as that of thumping a partition to make out the sound of a joist by the sound evoked should not early have been applied to the human chest. But, be this as it may, to Laennec belongs the great credit of having laid a substantial foundation for the physical diagnosis of the present time, and, more than for laying a foundation, for constructing a fairly complete edifice. He who should now undertake to practice general medicine without having first made himself proficient in the detection and interpretation of the sounds elicited by auscultation and percussion in diseases of the heart and lungs would foredoom himself to failure. It was not until many years later, early in the second half of the century, that the clinical thermometer came into general use, but it soon showed most strikingly the superiority of the instrument of precision to the unaided senses of man. Who would think now of trying to estimate the height of a fever by laying his hand on the patient's skin, or who, even among the laity, would be satisfied with such a procedure? Doubtless, said the present writer in a former publication, New York Medical Journal, December 29, 1900. The use of the thermometer has occasionally given rise to needless alarm, but almost invariably it may be interpreted with great certainty. It often dispels unnecessary anxiety as in a twinkling by its negative indication, and surely it is to be credited with being distinctly diagnostic in those diseases of which it has itself established the curve. By the thermometric curve of a disease is understood the general visual impression made by the graphic chart of a temperature record, the course of a zigzag line connecting the points indicated by the various individual observations. Numerous other instruments of precision are now in constant use, among the most wonderful of which, perhaps, is the ophthalmoscope, whereby we are enabled to subject the retina and intervening media of the eye to minute visual examination. There is not an organ of the body that is not now interrogated daily in the way of physical diagnosis, and we even examine separately the secretion of each of the two kidneys. In addition, there are multitudinous specific signs of which we were not long ago in complete ignorance. To cite only one of these, there is Weidel's agglutination test, by which the bacteriologist can usually make a diagnosis of typhoid fever far in advance of the time at which it could otherwise be distinguished. The use of the Röntgen rays in diagnosis was one of the crowning achievements of the century, and now we seem about to enter upon a course of their successful employment in the treatment of disease, even some forms of cancer, as well as in its detection. Beyond the vermin that infest the skin and hair, tapeworm and a few other intestinal worms, little if anything was known of morbific parasites before the 19th century, but the labors of Van Beneden, Kuchenmeister, Kobold, Manson, Leverin, and others have now established the casual relationship between great numbers of animal parasites, gross and microscopic, and certain definite morbid states. This has led to a great increase in our knowledge of the connection between the parasites of the lower animals and grave disease in human beings, and on this knowledge rest many of the precautions that we are now able to take against the spread of such disease. From the consideration of animal parasites as the direct causes of disease, we naturally come to the contemplation of the subject of insects as the carriers of disease. The later years of the century have witnessed the demonstration of the fly's agency in the transmission of malignant pustule and typhoid fever, and that of certain mosquitoes in the conveyance of yellow fever and malarial disease. We now know that bad air, the original meaning of the word malaria, has nothing to do with fever and ague, and that swamps are not unwholesome if they are free from infected mosquitoes. The mosquito does not originate the malarial infection, it simply serves as the temporary host of the microorganism, Plasmodium malariae, which is the cause of the disease, having obtained its transient guest from some human being. Consequently, marshy districts that are full of mosquitoes are not malarious unless the mosquitoes are of the kinds capable of lodging the Plasmodium, and unless there is or has recently been present in the neighborhood some person affected with malarial disease. Moreover, the most virulently malarious region is a safe place of residence for human beings, provided they protect themselves absolutely against the bite of the mosquito. This has been strikingly demonstrated in the case of the Roman Campagna. From the disease-producing animal parasites, we come now to those that are believed to be of vegetable nature. Under the general name of bacteria, there are multitudes of microorganisms having pathogenic powers, each giving rise to some definite specific disease and certain associations of different bacteria causing particular morbid conditions. Generations ago, physicians had a glimmering of what we now term the germ theory of disease. From the disease-producing animal parasites, we come now to those that are believed to be of vegetable nature. Under the general name of bacteria, there are multitudes of microorganisms having pathogenic powers, each giving rise to some definite specific disease and certain associations of different bacteria causing particular morbid conditions. Generations ago, physicians had a glimmering of what we now term the germ theory of disease, as was shown by their use of such expressions as materiae morbi and morbid poisons. Even the definite relationship of special microscopic organisms to individual diseases was foreshadowed by Salisbury nearly 50 years ago. But it was not until years after those conceptions, and in no wise descended from or led up to by them, that an intelligible and satisfactory germ theory of disease was formulated. It is to Pasteur, the immortal chemist, that we owe this theory, as well as that of the attenuation of viruses, both of more than theoretical import, since they have given us aseptic surgery, the power of frequently preventing hydrophobia, the antitoxin treatment of diphtheria, and the ability to stay the hand of death in the form of many a stalking pestilence. Every infectious disease is now held to be due to its own particular microorganism, and many diseases that were not until recently thought to be infectious are now classed as such because they have been proved to be caused by living germs. Conspicuous among these diseases is pulmonary consumption. In the case of almost every one of these diseases, we have discovered the specific germ and are able to demonstrate its presence, either by its microscopical appearance, by its behavior on contact with certain stains, or by the forms that cultures of it assume. The microorganism of smallpox and that of cancer, the existence of which is assumed, have not yet been isolated. Some of these germs, like that of tetanus, lockjaw, gain entrance to the system only through a wound. Others, like those of typhoid fever and cholera, are swallowed. Others, like that of pneumonia, are inhaled. Still others, like that of tuberculosis disease, are either swallowed or inhaled. Some are believed to be transmissible to the unborn child, and a few are ordinarily harmless parasites, becoming pathogenic only when they accidentally gain access to other parts of the system than those which constitute their natural habitat. These microscopic organisms do not, by their mere presence, set up disease, unless indeed they are in such overwhelming numbers as to block the capillary blood vessels mechanically. Some of them are carried broadcast in the blood current, while others remain at the point of entrance. In either case, they elaborate certain products, termed toxins, which act either locally or through the circulation to cause the disease. These toxins eventually kill the microorganisms that produced them, quite as an animal may be smothered in its own exhalations, or at least they would do so if the host survived long enough for the completion of the process. Meantime, they have either killed the host or been defeated by certain very interesting natural processes. But before either of these occurrences has had time to take place, fortunately, in the great majority of instances, save those of exposure to the most deadly of infections, the vital power of the invaded individual has coped successfully with the invaders at the very point of attack, has repulsed the attacking party without appreciable impairment of its own force, and no illness results. For example, practically all of us inhaled the germ of consumption repeatedly, but most of us suffer no harm from it simply because the fluids which bathe the surface on which the germ effects a lodgment are endowed with properties which either kill the germ or rob it of its power for harm. But these properties suffice only when the general health is unimpaired. End of section 26. Section 27 of Beacon Lights of History, Volume 14, The New Era by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Kay Hand. Rudolf Virchow, Part 2. In case the attack is not successfully repelled at the outset, what happens? There begins a struggle between the invaders and what may be called the reserves of the organism, consisting of the white blood corpuscles, which undergo a great augmentation in number. These corpuscles are endowed with the faculty of amoeboid movement, that is to say, they may shoot out projections from their substance and even convert themselves for the time being into traps, seizing upon the pathogenic bacteria, incarcerating them within their own mass, and carrying them away to be thrust out of the system by organs whose function it is to eliminate extraneous matter. These corpuscles are, indeed, said figuratively to eat the malign microorganisms, whence they have been termed phagocytes, from the Greek phagein, to eat, and the Greek koutos, a cell. Also because they carry away refuse and noxious material, they have been called the scavengers of the system. By means of their amoeboid movement, they are enabled to worm themselves through inconceivably minute apertures in the blood vessels and attack and devour peccant matter wherever it may have effected a lodgment. These white corpuscles are also known as leukocytes, and their increase in number when they are called upon to resist bacterial invasion is spoken of as hyperleukocytosis. The discovery of their protective function is to be credited to Mechnikov, a Russian physician now teaching in Paris. When they migrate from the blood vessels in great numbers, they finally, after having fulfilled their office as phagocytes, degenerate into the corpuscular elements of pus, which is the creamy liquid contained in an abscess. Their migratory power was discovered by Kohnheim. But as a general thing, the phagocytes do not succeed in making away with all the pathogenic germs, or even with enough of them to prevent the illness which they tend to produce. The further combat is between the poisonous products, termed toxins, engendered by the bacteria, and certain antidotal substances called antitoxins, newly created in the watery portion of the blood by some wonderful provision of nature that is not yet well understood. Each infective disease has its special toxin, and for the destruction of each, the blood prepares its particular antitoxin. Possibly, however, some of the antitoxins may be efficacious against more than one kind of toxin, for there are physicians who are convinced that vaccination is a temporary preventative of whooping cough. But the elaboration of an antitoxin takes time, and the result in any given case, whether in recovery or in death, seems to be settled by the ability or inability of the vital powers of the individual to hold out until they are relieved by the evolution of the necessary amount of antitoxin. In the long run, provided the sick person survives, more antitoxin is generated than is required to save life. The excess remains in the system for a greater or lesser length of time, and this fact explains the individual's subsequent immunity to the disease from which he has recovered. Any fresh invading force of the microbes of that disease find that defensive preparations have been made in advance. In the case of some diseases, this acquired immunity is usually lifelong, as in that of smallpox. In others, of which influenza is a notable example, it is a rule very transitory, and there are all gradations between the two. It is thought that this acquired immunity to some diseases may be transmitted to the offspring, for it is quite certain that there are many people who are from birth insusceptible to scarlet fever, no matter what may be the extent of their exposure to that disease. The recognition of nature's elaboration of protective antitoxins has led to their artificial cultivation in the lower animals, and thus produced, they have been used with brilliant results in the prevention and cure of at least one formidable disease, diphtheria. The immense reduction of the mortality from this disease that has followed the introduction of the treatment with the artificial antitoxin we owe to Bering of Germany and Roux of France. Omitting unnecessary details, we may describe the process of obtaining diphtheria antitoxin as follows. A certain amount of diphtheretic poison of the bacteriological sort prepared by cultivating the diphtheria microbe is injected into the circulation of a horse. Sufficient to make the horse sick, but not enough to endanger his life. The horse's system straight away begins to elaborate the protective antitoxin, and there results from this one injection a sufficient amount of it to save the horse, although far too little to make the serum of his blood potent enough for medicinal use. Hence, after the lapse of a suitable interval, he is again injected with diphtheretic poison, and for the second time his blood begins to generate the antitoxin. And the process is repeated again and again, the virulence of the poison being increased each time until the horse's blood is fairly reeking with antitoxin. Then blood is drawn freely from the horse and is allowed to separate into clot and serum, the latter alone being the part destined for use. This serum is tested on a small animal that has been inoculated with a deadly dose of the diphtheretic poison. If it saves the little creature from death, it is assumed to be potent enough for use on humans, and handled with all possible precautions against putrefaction or any contamination with pathogenic bacteria, it is furnished to physicians, its degree of potency being designated in units. If in this brief article, which does not purport to be more than a sketch of the tremendous strides made by medicine in the 19th century, so much space has been given to the germ theory of disease, it is because the demonstration of the truth of that theory has been absolute and has constituted the very marrow of almost all the medical progress of the century that has been the outcome of continuous thought and study as opposed to chance and discovery. Such results as the germ theory has now led to in the treatment of diphtheria, it had already accomplished in the field of surgery as a consequence of that strict asepticism which, originating with Joseph Lister, now Lord Lister, and rapidly carried by him to a condition verging on technical completeness, was soon taken up by surgeons all over the world and brought well-nigh to perfection, so that the mortality of wounds of all sorts has been tremendously reduced, and many surgical operations are now practiced frequently, indeed, whenever the occasion for them arises, that before the days of Listerism would have been looked upon as almost tantamount to the patient's death warrant. More particularly is this the case as to operations which involve opening into the abdomen, the chest, or the cranium. So little risk now attaches to such operations properly performed that the opening of the abdominal cavity for the mere purpose of ascertaining the condition of its contents, exploratory laparotomy, as it is called, is a matter of constant occurrence. Curiously enough, in some way, not yet satisfactorily explained, that procedure in itself, without anything further being done, has in many instances resulted in the decided amelioration of a morbid condition, if not in its cure. A striking example of this is seen in the benefit that often results in cases of one form of consumption of the bowels, namely tuberculous disease of the membrane that lines the abdominal wall and invests the abdominal organs. This is not the only operation that does good mysteriously. That of cutting out a bit of the iris in a form of deep-seated eye disease, glaucoma, that tends toward complete blindness, is hardly more explicable. Neither is an incision of the capsule of the kidney for certain forms of Bright's disease, each of which stays the progress of the trouble in a goodly proportion of instances. Another of the great divisions of the healing art, that of midwifery, has been enhanced quite as much as general surgery by the employment of Listerism. The process of childbirth, although a perfectly natural one, almost necessarily carries with it a certain amount of laceration, and, through the wound surfaces thus produced, absorption of poisonous material was formerly so frequent that puerperal fever figured prominently in mortality reports. It was Oliver Wendell Holmes, a graduate in medicine and a professor in the Harvard Medical School, though we are accustomed to think of him only as a delightful writer, who first declared that puerperal fever was the product of infection from without the body, and Semmelweis demonstrated the truth of that proposition. Holmes was a teacher of physiology, and his study of that branch of medical science was in itself enough to convince him of the doctrine which he inculcated. Listerism must be credited not only with having added immensely to the safety of the major operations of surgery, but also with having led to the great improvement of their techniques by reason of the greatly increased frequency with which it has come to be thought justifiable to practice them. What we do again and again, we are apt in the end to do well, whereas that which we turn to only in despair and as rarely as possible, we do clumsily and imperfectly. Listerism has been unjustly alleged by a few to be unworthy of the appreciation in which it is held by the great majority of medical men of all countries. Simple cleanliness, it has been urged, is quite as efficient as the full Listerian precautions. This is begging the question for simple cleanliness. Chemical cleanliness is all that Listerism purports to accomplish. The use of antiseptics has been decried in the interest of asepticism, as if the whole purpose of antiseptism were not to cure asepsis. Lord Lister is entitled to the full credit of establishing the aseptic surgery of the present day, in spite of the facts that his doctrine followed, rather than preceded, his early improvements, that aseptic procedures have been brought nearer perfection elsewhere than in his own country, and that the whole system rests on foundations laid by Pasteur. While it is quite true that to the Listerian theory and practice are almost wholly to be ascribed the favorable results of the major surgery of the present day, we must not forget the immeasurable benefits to the diseased, the injured, and the crippled that have arisen from patient efforts and occasional brilliant intuition that have had no connection with the germ theory of infection. Take the case of a broken leg, for example. An injury that formerly condemned the victim to weeks and weeks of confinement in bed, together with the suffering and danger almost inseparable from the old methods of the long, straight, splint, and tight bandaging. At the present time, he who has met with such misfortune is commonly able to be about on crutches within a few days, and his broken bone mends while he is cultivating his appetite and indulging in pleasant intercourse with his fellow men. This great change has been made possible by one device after another, invented by different men. Josiah Crosby introduced the use of sticking plaster for extension, instead of the chafing bands previously employed. Gurdon Buck substituted elastic extension by means of a weight and pulley for the rude and arbitrary traction in vogue before. James L. Little devised the plaster of Paris splint, whereby broken bones were immobilized with hardly appreciable discomfort. And Henry B. Sands established the safety and practicability of applying the plaster of Paris splint almost immediately after the reduction, setting, of the fracture. In the meantime, Nathan R. Smith and John T. Hodgen had demonstrated the advantages of suspending a fractured limb from above. All these men were Americans. Surely our country has contributed powerfully to the well-being of the subjects of fracture. Other Americans, notably Louis A. Sayre, have enabled sufferers with joint disease, including the dreaded hip disease, to run about and gain health and strength, instead of languishing in bed. Sayre, too, by his suspension treatment and the plaster of Paris jacket, set the hunchback on his feet at a stage in his disease in which before he had been forced to prolonged and painful recumbency. Although men professing special skill in certain operations, and doubtless possessing it, flourished in old times, and left more or less of their impress on the surgery of the present day, for that matter, it was not until the second half of the 19th century that regional surgery, which is what specialism virtually amounts to, was systematically cultivated. Now there is hardly a portion of the body to which practitioners who make its ailments especially do not direct their searching methods of examinations or on which they do not practice their ingenious devices in the way of treatment. Specialism has always been decried by a large section of the medical profession. On the other hand, it has been and is still overrated by the laity. The true estimate lies between the two. The specialists have advanced surgery immensely, but, with many honorable exceptions, they have laid too much stress on their several specialties, making too wide a range of ailments fall within them. As for the community at large, their shortcoming lies in the fact that most of them would seek for a specialist in mumps, in case that painful but transitory infliction were to come upon them, and in their underrating of the family physician. To change for a moment to a topic akin to the germ theory of disease, the reader may be reminded that the antitoxin treatment of infectious disease involves in almost every instance the use of some product contained in the serum, that is to say, the watery part of the blood. This leads to the subject of the use of natural and artificial serum in the treatment of disease. To quote again from the article entitled The 19th Century in Medicine, New York Medical Journal, December 29, 1900, it has been observed that the normal serum of certain animals that are insusceptible to particular infectious diseases, if injected into the human blood current or even into the subcutaneous tissue, confers more or less of immunity against those diseases. Artificial serum seems to have been first employed by Edmund R. Peasley as a benign application to the peritoneum in the operation of ovariotomy. His conception of its mode of action is not very clear, but he was a very successful ovariotomist, and we can only conjecture that he builded better than he knew, like many another man. A few years ago, much was expected from transfusion of blood, but gradually the conviction has forced itself upon us that it is well nigh useless, indeed, that on the whole, it is worse than useless. It has virtually been abandoned, but experiments in transfusion have not been fruitless. They have culminated in demonstrating the inestimable value of infusions of normal or physiological solutions of sodium chloride, and not only of infusions, but also of peritoneal irrigation with such solutions. Many a life has been saved by resorting to this measure, even in apparently desperate cases. Within about a decade of the close of the century, Robert Cook, whose discoveries and ingenious studies in bacteriology had brought him worldwide renown, announced that he had produced a derivative of the tubercle bacillus, which he termed tuberculin, that he thought might prove curative of tuberculosis disease. It was to be injected beneath the skin. If the subject was really tuberculous, he would react by manifesting a certain degree of fever, and repeated injections would bring about elimination of the tuberculous deposits and thus effect a cure. The world was carried away with such an announcement coming from such a man, and it was thoroughly believed that at last the great white plague, consumption, was to be conquered. Tuberculin did, indeed, cure certain minor forms of tuberculous disease, such as the skin affection known as lupus, but it soon became evident that it was almost impotent in the treatment of pulmonary consumption. It has, however, served to enable the veterinarian to make out the existence of tuberculous disease in cattle at an early stage of its course, and it is probable that by the slaughter of cattle thus found to be tuberculous, much infection of human beings has been prevented. Tuberculin failed of its prime purpose, but it does seem to have marked the initiative of a campaign against consumption, which has already proved of incalculable benefit, and bids fair to put that omnipresent disease toward the foot of the list of causes of death. We have made substantial advances in our knowledge of the disease, and we no longer regard it as incurable. We have learned that it is communicable from one person to another, but also that its communication can be easily prevented, so that there is no reason to shrink from association with tuberculous persons. We have learned, too, that consumption in one's progenitors, immediate or remote, hardly makes it even probable that he himself is doomed to suffer with it. The only tuberculous heredity that we now recognize is that of defective ability to withstand the infection, and even this we regard as in most instances readily surmountable. We have learned, furthermore, that pulmonary tuberculous disease is by no means so fatal as it was formerly esteemed, for men whose business it is to make great numbers of post-mortem examinations, such as coroners, physicians, and hospital pathologists, assure us that in a very large percentage of cases of death from other causes, they find indubitable signs of past tuberculous disease of the lungs, which had ceased its activity, been in fact cured, either spontaneously or by medical intervention. Such intervention, it has been abundantly proved, is altogether likely to be successful if it is of the right sort and employed early. There is, to be sure, no cure-all. Powerful as the climatic treatment is, it must be supplemented by measures accurately adapted to the individual case, and failure to comprehend this fact still leads many a phthisical person to his grave. But information is rapidly being diffused. Sanatoria for such of the tuberculous as can take advantage of them are multiplying, and those who are shut off from their aid are growing more and more cognizant of how they should live in order to give themselves the best chance of recovery and to save their associates from infection. The era of consumption cures, meaning drugs, is past, but the disease is cured in an ever-increasing proportion of instances, and that too by medical, though not medicinal, measures. End of section 27. Section 28 of Beacon Lights of History, Volume 14, The New Era, by John Lord. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by K. Hand. Rudolf Virchow, Part 3. At almost every turn, medicine has been powerfully assisted by the sciences, which should rather be termed correlative than subsidiary. Notable among them is chemistry. The isolation of the active principles of medicinal plants, such as morphine, quinine, strychnine, and cocaine, has been a remarkable service rendered by chemistry to medicine. How should we be handicapped if we still had to fight malarial disease with the crude Peruvian bark instead of its chief alkaloid, quinine? and how impracticable, if not impossible, would it be to render the eye insensitive to pain with any extract of coca leaves, no matter how concentrated? A purpose we accomplish almost instantly with cocaine. Of minor importance, perhaps, but not to be despised, is the resulting liberation from the old slavery to bulky and nauseous drugs. The isolation of active principles long antedated the synthetical preparations, but the latter came at last. The marvelous array of hypnotics, anodynes, and fever quellers that are now at our command, largely coal tar products. But it is not pure chemistry alone that we are indebted for the elegant dosing of the present day. Progressive pharmacy, with its tablets, its coated pills, and its capsules, has put to shame the old-time purveyor of galenicals. Right jauntily do we now take our soda mint in case of slight derangement of the stomach, happily oblivious of its vile prototype, the old rhubarb and soda mixture. Even castor oil has been stripped of its repulsiveness by the combinations which the soda water fountain affords. It was but a step, we can now realize, from the employment of isolated vegetable principles to that of preparations of certain glandular organs of the animal economy. But the doctrine of internal secretions had to intervene, and evolution took its time. Not till toward the close of the century did the venerable Brown Séquard lead up to it. We have not yet come to eye of newt and toe of frog, but what we have incorporated into modern therapeutics in the way of animal products lends at least some theoretical justification to the ancient use of the dried organs of various animals. It is but a few years since the ductless glands, such organs as, for example, the thyroid gland, an organ situated in the front of the neck, a small affair in its normal state, but prominent and even pendulous when by its permanent enlargement it comes to constitute a goiter, were looked upon as puzzles, as structures destitute of any known function. Some observers even affirmed that they had no function, though the constancy of goiter in cretins ought to have shown the fallacy of this allegation in the case of the thyroid. We do not now need to be told that the thyroid gland plays a very important part in the economy, for we know that its surgical removal gives rise to a special disease known as myxoedema, which in addition to its physical manifestations is characterized by impairment of the mental powers. Consequently, this ductless gland, a gland that is to say which has no obvious canal by which it throws off any product of its activity, must elaborate some material that is necessary to the health of the organism and is imparted to the blood. That material, whatever it may be, is termed an internal secretion. Some of the internal secretions have turned out to be of singular value medicinally. It is apparently not the ductless glands alone that furnish internal secretions. The glands that are provided with ducts and yield a definite and observable product secrete also a substance, perhaps more than one, which they give up to the blood. Prominent among the therapeutic advances of the century is the direct reduction of the high temperature of sunstroke and certain fevers by the use of cold. Although foreshadowed by Curie early in the century by his use of cold effusion in the treatment of scarlet fever, it did not come into general use until the closing decades. It is employed principally in typhoid fever, on the theory that a condition of high fever is in itself a source of danger quite distinct from the other injurious effects of a febrile disease. On the other hand, the employment of high degrees of heat has of late been shown to be a potent agency in the treatment of certain forms of disease, notably in various affections classed as rheumatic. Applications of very hot air, provided it is thoroughly dry, are borne without serious discomfort, and their employment promises to be of greater service in the conditions in which it is resorted to than that of any other agent. A revelation in the treatment of heart disease has been effected by the Bad-Nauheim system of effervescent baths and resisted exercises. It is not only functional disorders of the heart that are relieved, but grave organic diseases also. Somewhat elaborate explanations of the way in which the treatment proves beneficial have been given, but they are not altogether satisfactory. Thus far, we have dealt chiefly with those developments of medicine that seem to have been the outgrowth of much thought and experiment, but there was one that can hardly be viewed as other than a happy discovery, yet it was one that was fraught with unspeakable mitigation of human suffering, and that wrought a boundless extension of the field of surgery. It was that of anesthesia. The first to discover an efficient surgical anesthetic was Crawford W. Long of Georgia. It has been established that he performed several minor operations with the patient anesthetized with sulfuric ether, but he did not proclaim his discovery, and so it was reserved for William T.G. Morton of Boston, then a dentist, but subsequently a physician, to make the first public demonstration of the efficiency of ether as an anesthetic, which he did in the operating theater of the Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston in the year 1846. The news of Morton's achievement spread broadcast, and it was at once realized that it was destined to revolutionize surgery. It certainly has done that, and in no less degree than was afterward accomplished by Listerism. Ether did not long remain the only anesthetic known. Simpson of Edinburgh soon discovered that chloroform was possessed of even more decided anesthetic properties. The inhalation of ether is disagreeable, and it is slow in producing the desired effect, whereas that of chloroform is not unpleasant, and it acts more rapidly. Consequently, chloroform soon came to be generally preferred, but abundant experience has finally shown that ether is the much safer agent of the two, and improved methods of administration have almost entirely done away with the objections to its use, so that now it is looked upon as the preferable general anesthetic. But general anesthesia, meaning the suspension of sensibility in the whole organism inducing unconsciousness, is not always necessary, and sometimes it is undesirable. We have now trustworthy local anesthetics, the chief of which is cocaine, wherewith we are able to anesthetize the parts to be operated on without rendering the patient unconscious. And the cooperation that a conscious patient may be able to render is sometimes valuable. It was not alone in the direct saving of human suffering that anesthetics proved a boon to the world. They have made possible an amount of experimental work on animals in the way of vivisection that humane investigators would otherwise have shrunk from, necessary as it has been and still is for the advancement of the healing art. The operation of ovariotomy, first performed by Ephraim McDowell of Kentucky, can hardly be classed with the happy accidents, but so little has been said about it or thought concerning it that when the news of it reached Europe from the wilds of America, the editor of a ponderous English quarterly journal of medicine recorded his incredulity with the words, "Credat judoesis non ego." An ovarian tumor inevitably proves fatal in the long run if it is not removed. In a certain percentage of cases, it is malignant and will kill whether it is removed or not, but the general result of ovariotomy has been the saving of thousands of women from untimely death. Bell of Edinburgh had imagined the operation and had mentioned it in his lectures, but nonetheless to McDowell is due the credit of demonstrating its feasibility. Medicine bore quite its full share in the mitigation of the horrors and hardships of war that marked the 19th century. Its work was shown in the great reduction of pestilential disease incident to camp life, in prompt aid to the wounded, in the establishment of salubrious field and general hospitals, and in improved methods of transportation of the sick and wounded. Certainly the soldier on the sick list never before had such a fair prospect of rejoining his comrades safe and sound as he has now. In the care of the insane, too, care not only in the sense of humane treatment, but in the systematic employment of measures for their restoration to mental soundness, the century has been marked by notable progress. This has been chiefly in the direction of preventing insanity, and although mental disease is said to be on the increase, it may undoubtedly be said with entire truth that its growing prevalence is not in proportion to the heightened frequency of the strenuous life. We may confidently expect that a more pronounced mastery over diseases of the mind will come when physicians in general are taught psychiatry clinically, so that the beginnings of mental alienation may be intelligently met by the family practitioner. The supreme achievement of the medicine of the 19th century undoubtedly has been the development of its preventative feature. When we recall the fact that but a few years ago an attack of infectious disease was interpreted as a visitation of Providence, by a perversity that even the triumphs of vaccination did not serve to do away with, when we contemplate the well-ordered and well-understood measures that are now resorted to in an ever-increasing number of communities, and resorted to not solely on the outbreak of an epidemic, but at all times, to purify the air we breathe, the food we eat, and the water we drink, and when we reflect upon the greatly reduced morbidity as well as mortality of most infectious diseases, we must realize the immense service that has been rendered by preventative medicine. No doubt we must all die sometime, and the day is yet far remote when the only causes of death will be old age and injury, but a decided prolongation of the average lifetime, such as the life insurance companies recognize, is an unquestionable gain to the human race. A great blessing that has been brought about in great measure by medical men has been the establishment of the profession of nursing. The work of caring for the sick between the physician's visits is no longer, at least in large communities and in the cases of severe illness, left to oversympathetic and uninstructed relatives or to outsiders who traded on mystery. An intelligent and intelligible record is now kept of all important happenings in the sick room. Remedies are administered as they were ordered. Needless alarm at something deemed by the patient to be of ill omen is quelled, and in the case of real emergency, overlooked as it might otherwise have been, the physician is summoned to meet it. The advent of the trained nurse marked an era in medicine. The literature of medicine has fully kept pace in volume with the progress of the art itself, and its quality has steadily improved. To this, the great tomes of that gigantic work, the Index Catalogue of the Library of the Surgeon General's Office, United States Army, bear solid testimony. It is a consolidated catalogue, by subjects and by authors' names, of practically every medical book published throughout the world, and of every article in the periodical literature of medicine. For its existence, the world is indebted to Dr. John S. Billings, formerly a surgeon of high rank in the Army and now the director of the New York Public Library, and for its continued existence to the United States government. And it is to be hoped that Congress will never cease to provide adequately for its continued publication. Its completeness and its accuracy long ago led to its being prized everywhere. There are some problems of which medicine has hardly yet entered upon the solution. Prominent among them is that of cancer. Little as we now know of the real nature of that disease, we know quite as much of it as we knew but a few years ago concerning other diseases equally destructive and far more prevalent, which, however, we have now practically mastered. Who can say that we shall not triumph over cancer while the 20th century is still young? Our final triumph is indubitable. The strongest individuality in the medicine of the 19th century was, without a doubt, that of Rudolf Ludwig Karl Virchow, commonly written by him simply Rudolf Virchow. Although he took no direct part in any of the striking advances in practice that appealed to the laity, yet he was recognized the world over, among all classes of educated and well-informed persons, as the one beacon light of 19th century medicine whose glow had been the steadiest and the most enduring. This is because of the wide range of his learning in matters not pertaining closely to his profession. His professional brethren hold the same view, and this is because he so well controlled himself, checked himself at every turn by the severest application of system, that he continued for more than half a century an anchor to hold medical thought strictly down to fact. This was from no natural lack of volatility, for he was an Acht- und Versiger, 48er. In 1846, as a prosector in the University of Berlin, Virchow entered with Reinhardt upon a series of pathological investigations which at once received wide attention. In conjunction with Reinhardt, he found the Archiv für Pathologische Anatomie und Psychologie und für Klinische Medizin, a periodical familiarly called Virchow's Archive, the publication of which was begun in the year 1847. Reinhardt died in 1852, leaving the editorship in the hands of Virchow alone, and he was still its editor up to the time of his death on September 5, 1902. In consequence of his having openly proclaimed himself a Democrat in 1848, Virchow was forced to retire from the University of Berlin in the following year. He was at once made a professor in the University of Würzburg, whence 7 years later, in 1856, as a result of the strenuous interposition of various medical organizations, he was recalled to Berlin, where he was made a professor and director of the Pathological Institute. He was appointed medical privy counselor in 1874, having several years before that entered upon an active political career and been one of the founders of the Progressive Party, which he ably represented in the Landtag and the Reichstag. In 1869, he took part in founding the German and Berlin Anthropological Societies, of each of which he was several times president. Virchow investigated the most diverse subjects, as his profound studies of Schliemann's discoveries, as well as other archaeological researches, show, and he was a rather prolific writer. The most important of his early works was Die Cellular Pathologie, the first edition of which was published in 1858. Chance's English translation appeared in 1860, and Picard's French version came out in 1861. It is safe to say that no book of the century exerted a profounder influence on medical thought than Virchow's exposition of the cellular pathology. His next notable publication was a collection of 30 lectures on tumors, Die Krankhaften Gesellschaft, Berlin, 1863-67. To say that he was not too absorbed in these lectures to bring his great powers to bear upon the topics of the day is shown by the fact that before their publication was completed, he brought out his work on Trinity, Darstellung der Lehre von den Trichinen, 1864. Old age found him with industry and versatility unabated, for it was in 1892 that his Crania Ethnica Americana appeared, and after that time he wrote a vigorous protest against the newfangled spelling of German language, which he accused the schoolmasters of trying to foist on the people. This was published in his archive. It may well be that his arguments have not been unavailing, since it is observable that several German publications that had adopted the new spelling have now dropped it. It must not be supposed that it was by his literary work alone, founded though it was manifestly on his profound study, that Virchow impressed his personality upon medicine. It was in his lectures and in his laboratory teaching, too, that he made himself felt. In all civilized countries, there are many devoted workers in medical science who caught their first real inspiration from Virchow. The writer once saw Virchow. Only once, but it was a sight never to be forgotten. It was at a banquet given as one of the festivities incident to the annual meeting of the British Medical Association in London, 1873. The company was not a large one, but it included such celebrities as Professor J. Burton Sanderson, Sir William Jenner, Professor Chaveau, and Professor Mary. Virchow was conspicuously the man toward whom the eyes of all others were oftenest directed. Virchow met with the love as well as the admiration of his contemporaries, and both sentiments will descend to their successors, for his impress on the records of medicine is indelible, both as an instructor and as a friend of all real truth seekers. Authorities. There is no full and connected account of the progress of medicine during the 19th century, but the reader may consult with profit the various medical biographies, also the following works. Silliman's A Century of Medicine and Chemistry, Jenner's The Practical Medicine of Today, Buck's Reference Handbook of the Medical Sciences, Uhlenberg's Real Encyclopädie der Gesamten Heilkund, and Annus Medicus, published in The Lancet at the close of each year, and Tinker's America's Contributions to Surgery, Bulletin of the Johns Hopkins Hospital, August to September, 1902. End of Section 28. End of Beacon Light of History, Volume 14, The New Era, by John Lord.